Okay, everyone, just before this episode starts, please, 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 please click the subscribe button. Basically, it just helps us get found by more people will listen to the podcast if you click the subscribe button. And of course, it doesn't cost you anything, it literally takes 1 second. So please go and do that. Really appreciate that. You can also listen to these episodes on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play, wherever you listen to podcasts. You can support and get access to early access to all the episodes that we do and all the interviews we do by supporting us on Patreon. So go to patreon.com/legitpodcast. The link is below in the description. And finally, if you could follow us on social media, that'd be brilliant. Instagram, it's the Legit Podcast, and Twitter, it's the Legit Podcast. So links will be below as well to that. Enjoy this episode. Radio, welcome. We're live. It's the Legit Podcast. And we're joined once again by Mark Scanney. Thank you so much, mate.
B-A-C-K, aren't I?
Mate, thank you. So I must just say that this episode is obviously being released on the 10th of August, and we'll talk about Awake. But I just wanted to first start off by saying that this morning, me and Andy, five other people, went to the beach at Crosby at 5:30 in the morning. And I actually really needed something like that this morning. Like this, I've had like just these past 2 weeks, I just haven't been the same. I don't know what it is. I just, there's a bit of a lack of motivation. And mate, this morning when I went there with 500 other people, Andy said it before, I've never ever driven away from somewhere and felt like I can fucking take on the world. Yeah. Like, and I mean that. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much, mate. Honestly, I really do appreciate
it. Job done then, eh?
100%.
I said to you, mate, after obviously you've only just been on the podcast, and I felt like I try not to look in, maybe it's unprofessional, but I try not to look in too much to the guests because I like it to be natural and have a natural combo. And obviously when it was great hearing about you and your life, and then when you kind of started speaking, I was like, fucking hell, you could do a podcast just on your way of thinking and what you're doing now and stuff. So it's great that we've got you back to speak again, so I appreciate it. And also the one thing I've said to you numerous times, I've said to Tom, was I've just felt like for maybe a couple of years even, that I've just felt like just been ticking along, do you know what I mean? And there's maybe something that, there's a fire there, but it's only like a little, you know, just a tiny little light. And I've needed something, like Tom said, whether that's this morning, to get you going again. And listening to your, just the way you're, what you're doing in the city right now, your way of living, your way of thinking, I've been like, fuck me. Like, mate, since our last podcast, I've been having cold showers every morning.
Yeah.
Been down the beach with like five, six hundred people this morning, and the knock-on effect, just those couple of things I've had, just that alone, has been mental. And looking at the posts from social media after the last pod, you can see that it's not just me and Tom going, "Hey mate, great that." You can see people physically, like, mate, it's mad. It makes me speechless.
Getting tagged every morning by people like just in that place saying, "Win your morning, win your day." I'm like, get in.
There's so many little sound bites off our last podcast, mate, that was just, people were just going, fuck me, like, do you know what I mean? And I always know when it's a good podcast because, you know, like lads you went to school with, who you meet but you just don't see anymore, I get random texts off those lads, fucking boss that one, fucking boss that. So, mate, it hit home on so many levels to so many different people, so thank you again.
Yeah.
Thank you for having me on.
Good. Mate, and also I must just say as well, like, for anyone, like, obviously we you know, Crosby Beach Leisure Centre at 5:30 in the morning every single Thursday. Look, we're doing a podcast now, it's 6:30, so I've technically been up since 4:30, so that's 14 hours. So 14 hours, usually I'd be up at 7:00, so I'd be like 9, this is 9 o'clock for me, slowly starting to get into bed.
Yeah.
And yet I'm still going, do you know what I mean? Mm, I'm wide awake and I'm still going. So like, if I can do, so that we're up to 14 hours, I'm going to go to bed at 10 o'clock, which is what, another like 16 hours, right? Mm. Yeah, 16 hours. Like, I only have to do that 5 times. Look, Monday through to Friday, right? That difference is 4 hours. That's 20 hours. That's a whole day I've just gained from just getting up.
That's mad when you think of it like that.
Like, it's near enough a whole day.
I've just gained a day a week.
A day a week from just getting up at 5:30.
Yeah.
And you know what? I could fucking do it tomorrow. I could go to Crosby Beach tomorrow and I could go on my own. I could swim in the fucking sea.
Yeah.
Mate, and for me, I was worried because I'm one of these people, like, I need sleep. Like, I've just always had it in my head. Maybe it's my subconscious, whatever, of going like, you know, you need sleep, you need sleep. I was like, oh, I'm going to be fucked today getting up. And mate,
you've been charged all day.
I've done a little video saying like the hardest bit of today was getting out of bed or putting my leg on. Like, that was for me the hardest bit. Putting my leg on, genuinely, because You know, the workout, you can say, oh yeah, it's not like a proper fucking big heavy workout. You've done harder workouts, you've been colder before, you've got in colder water, you've done all these things which are a little bit uncomfortable or pushing yourself a bit. But the hardest bit for me was going, right, come on, let's go. That was the hardest bit. And I bet you it was for loads of people. Because it's just that thing in your head, isn't it? Going, right, come on.
I give you a little tip for that. So people who struggle to get out of bed, I do a countdown. So I'll give myself a 5-second countdown to get out of bed. So the minute I open my eyes, I'm 5, 4, 3, and I've got to be out of bed before I hit the one. And it's the most simple thing in the world.
I might give myself 10. I've got to put a leg on. I'm going to give myself 10 seconds.
5-second countdown. I promise you, you'll be out that bed.
No, mine's going 10 by the time I put a leg on, but I like it. I'm going to use that.
Give you an extra 5 seconds. God, lad, yeah.
But no,
so, mate the reason why we obviously it was, you know, well, it was all three of us here wanted to do this podcast again is because when we last did it, and it's not just the beach, but we've without meaning to lick your ass, you know, we've mentioned you on a few podcasts recently since our conversation had, and to get you back on, it was because we had so many. Well, first of all, we had a massive response, and secondly, so many questions came up of that we wanted to talk about personally, and what other people have got for you, whether it's like, you know, that generic phrase, which is how to be successful, or, you know, like this morning, how to win your morning, a huge number of like different
loads
questions.
Loads of people were asking me about Awake as well, which was good. Loads of people going, massive, he's opening up a centre, isn't he? When's that opening? What are they going to be doing? So there was just that buzz of, we're going to have to speak to Mark again, because I didn't have all the answers when people were asking me. I was like, I don't know, follow him and go and see, you know.
It's mad because after the last one, even when I came away, there's always like things that I think, would have been nice to speak about that or nice to speak about that. So I am happy to get the opportunity to come back in and maybe talk in depth a little bit more over things what we didn't get to speak about last time, which I think that kind of information was.
What should we start on, the beach or the wake? What do you want to talk about first?
You want.
Right, I want to talk about the beach if that's okay then, because again, I've just mentioned it then. So I would start, I'd got up, I think I set my alarm for 4:45. And then got to the beach about 10 past. And it was raining, it was drizzly, wasn't it, this morning?
Yeah.
And it's pitch black, I could hear the winds, and my windscreen wipers are going, and I'm thinking, God, I hope I haven't built this up too much. I can't see, like, people doing this, you know, because it's a bit moody, the weather. And I got there and struggled to fucking park in the car park at now 5:15. And I was going, oh, this is fucking mad, this. I put my coat on and my bag with my towel in, went onto the beach, seeing a couple of lads, and I was buzzing that, like, because I told a couple of people about it, and I thought, are they going to, you know, are they going to do it? I was texting him, going, are you up and all that? And he's like, mate, I'm here. And anyway, we're there, I had a little chat, and you're seeing people you know and friend, you know, familiar faces and friendly faces, and you're like, just seeing the odd pit, you're getting a good, warm, fuzzy feeling. And then we walk on the beach, and I think we looked at each other, and I was like, it's getting to, like, now 5:20, and I'm going, there's fucking hordes of people just coming. There's hundreds and hundreds. I'm going, mate, there's already like 300 people here now. And he just kept coming and coming and coming. And then the rain went off a bit and the sun started getting brighter. And you're looking around and everyone's just, you can tell it's some of their first time. And there's just everyone's, these smiles on their faces. And there's people who were there last week who were hugging each other. Hey, are you all right again? How was your week? And I'm there going, this is fucking mad, this. Like, and the thing I kept on reminding myself is, it's 5:30 in the morning. I am normally got another 2-3 hours kipping me, and yet there I am with these butterflies standing on a fucking beach in it drizzle.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck's going on? And then obviously we get into it, your workout and all that. By this point, there's 500 or 600 people go through the workout with all the sound system and everything. Making the affirmation at the start, that was fucking cool. I wasn't expecting that.
Yeah.
You know, getting 500-600 people shouting, you know, the affirmation, I am a winner. That was powerful. And it's one of those things, if I'm being completely honest, the first time you're like, you feel a bit of a wally, like, I don't know, you'd be, well, I did anyway, but I am a, and then you just get this power from everyone else and you're like, nah, this is fucking cool to do this. And I'm like, I am a winner. I'm fucking screaming it.
But that's only like your ego, that basically saying.
Yeah, it was,
giving a shit what everyone around you thinks. And that's what, like, I'm big on.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, there's still things what I feel uncomfortable doing, but I've gone from not doing them if I feel uncomfortable to actually wanting to do them. If something makes me feel uncomfortable, it makes me want to do it even more. If that makes sense.
Mark, just pull that mic like about a fist away from your spot. Okay, yeah, perfect, mate. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I can see that, mate. It's good to, you know, make yourself uncomfortable. And that was one for me. I felt, and then, but after like the second, third time, I was fucking screaming it.
Yeah. But affirmations are powerful. Like trying not to go off subject, but affirmations are a big part of my like daily routine. I say them a lot to myself and create my own affirmations. And all an affirmation is affirming something to yourself. So a lot of people tend to affirm things negatively without realising that they're doing it. But when you learn what affirmations are and how you can use them to benefit you, then you can create affirmations which empower you, because
you're just saying these in your head or out loud, are you saying?
An affirmation, just an I am. And like the programme running the schools is the I Am Project. And it's basically your body's made up of 50 trillion cells. And the minute you say I am, imagine there's a little receptor on every single cell in your body and it just goes ping. And it's waiting to see what you are. So if you're like, I am tired, I am tired, I am tired, within 5 minutes you're going to start falling asleep.
Yeah, knackered, yeah.
You know what I mean? So you can convince yourself that you're tired by your I ams and your affirmations, because even though you don't intend to be using an affirmation, we do affirmations without realising that we're doing it, because anything what you tell yourself you are, that's an affirmation. So I am a winner might only sound like a word, but you're actually creating a winner in yourself by saying them words and attaching feelings and emotions to it. So the first one you might go, I am a winner. But the next one you're like, I am a winner. By the time you get to like the 10th time, like, I am a winner. And you start to believe it yourself. So, you know, it's down to like your positive and your negative self-talk. But affirmations, if anyone's watching them, there's loads of different affirmation videos on YouTube.
Mm.
They're brilliant for your kids, do you know what I mean?
And so, you know, you like your routine in the morning then? Like, does it look a lot like what we saw at Crosby Beach this morning? Like starting off with that?
So, like my mission with Awake is to create perfect mornings for people. But that's based on my own morning. So I've practiced and tried different things to create my own perfect morning. So like I know now when the kids are in school and I've got my routine, it's like 10 to 5, my alarm goes off. You know, 10 past 5, I'm meditating. That's in the meantime, I've had a swill my face. I've had maybe a big drink of water. A little 5 minutes to get me head together, and then I'll meditate for maybe 15-20 minutes. I've got a gym in the house which I do an hour cardio pretty much every single day, 7 days a week. In that hour cardio, I'll listen to audiobooks on different things, psychology, neurology, loads of motivational stuff. Like I watch tons, send you loads, don't I?
Yeah, I love them, lads.
Motivational videos.
Yeah.
So that's like an hour I charge myself up in the morning. As soon as I finish, I'm finished around, if I start, say, half six.
Half six, yeah.
Basically, by the time my kids have got out of bed at 7:30, I've made my plans for the day, I've read for 20 minutes, I've trained for an hour, and while I've been training my body, obviously I'm training my brain as well, because I'm the things that I'm watching and listening to, and I'm motivating myself to try and get my energy high. And like that's all before the kids have got out of bed, and then I'm blessed to be in a situation where I can drop my kids off at school every day and then my work day starts. So it's like you say before, over that couple of hours in the morning, I spend 2 hours every morning working on myself before my day starts. So I obviously take that then into my working day. And you find that when you've set yourself up for the day like that, a lot of opportunities come and you're generally happy and people want to work with you. And that's like...
You know what I've took from that as well, mate? I do a thing in my talks and I always say, like, you know, control the controllables and stuff. And what I feel you're doing there is the first 2 hours of your day, you're in control of them. And, you know, you're doing your perfect morning.
Yeah.
And I feel like a lot of people who are maybe getting up at, you know, crawling out of bed at 8:15, quick shower and then on the train or whatever for 8:30 or in the car, their day is starting... But it's been affected by loads of possible other outcomes. For example, you know, they go
like
drive,
a late train or
drive down to the road and someone cuts them up, or if someone, you know, it's a road closure or whatever, they maybe like first half hour, 45 minutes, hour of the day is potentially being affected in a negative way because their head's not right, they're rushing around, they're doing this, doing that. But I'm guessing by the time you're at that stage at that same time in the morning, 8:30.
Yeah,
your head's screwed on. You've
at
already...
any point in any day, especially for me with the different things that I'm involved in, I can get sidetracked or I can be late somewhere, or you know, something can happen to take me off track, and it does pretty often. But I've had 2 hours every morning to focus on myself completely. So like you say, I laugh and say there's no such thing as a bad day, there's good days and character building days, but in general, if every day in some way I've progressed or learned something or worked on myself, I've still got something positive to take out of that day. So I'm going to have the shittest day ever after I've dropped the kids off at school. But it's never really a shit day. Like I call them character building days, but I've still had that 2 hours in the morning. So even if your day doesn't go to plan, I still know I can fall back on that 2 hours where I've worked on myself every single morning. And I know in some way I'm constantly progressing and learning. And you know, I spoke last time over like my motivation behind learning and stuff like that. Now is obviously because the stuff I'm doing with Awaken, I want to help kids and, you know, help adults as well. Obviously, because all this stuff what I've practiced for maybe 8-9 years now, working on myself and self-development, has basically created the life what I've got now, in which I'm obviously really blessed. And I've got everything what I want just through working on myself, not through like any outside events, through creating like, the, you know, basically being the very best I can be, being a nice person, trying to help people anytime I can. And just in general, just trying to be positive and just constantly developing all the time. And
it is massive, that first 2 hours, mate, because again, I'm the worst, especially, I'm lucky, like I say, I work myself, so I can also take my daughter to school and that, and I'm very blessed to do that. But when she stays with her mum, I have a 50-50, I can be guilty of going, well, I'm not in the gym with the lads till 9:15, so I walk the dog for half an hour, so I might not get up till a bit later and stuff, whereas when I've got my daughter, I'm on it then, do you know what I mean? But I do then have those laps where I'm thinking, you know, but just hearing you say that, you could just, like, you're just in control, like you say, aren't you? Your own destiny.
9:15 is usually like my second gym session, so there's a lot of days. By midday, I've trained twice.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, you know, I might have to work late some days.
I always remember, like, I was down in Headley Court, the rehab centre, and she spoke to us about, like, mental health and stuff, and it was like, I can't remember the whole thing she said, but I always remember saying, you know, if you're running late for something or you're getting stressed, anxious about something, you'll always go to like the last thing. So like, if you were late to something or you missed a train, you'll go, it was because that fella cut me up then, the last thing. You would go and ever go, it was because maybe this morning that happened or that happened. You'll only ever go back to, if it wasn't for him, he'd let me through, I would have been there. And you're always, or like if you start your day and you stub your toe, it's like, oh, well, today's going to be a bad day then. You know, all these little negative things then and spiraling to a bad day, whereas by having your morning, it's like whatever could happen, like I say, it could be a character building day, but you know for those first 2.5 hours in the morning, you've done your meditation, you've done your workout, you've took your kids to school, you've done this, so, okay, yeah, if I do stub my toe, or if I am late, it's not the worst thing.
A lot of the stuff what, like, I study and listen to in the morning teaches you that if you stub your toe, you stub your toe, that doesn't mean that something bad's going to, the only time something bad happens is if you stub your toe and then you put yourself in a negative frame of mind. Yeah. And then you start attracting negative.
How many times have you heard that? Oh, it's going to be a fucking shit day. This, like, people say those, like yeah, sayings, aren't they? That people.
And that's an affirmation. Yeah, so they're affirming to themselves every day that the day's going to be shit. And then they complain that they're having a shit day.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, another one's people, like, you speak to people and, it's like, I get quite a lot of people now speaking to me and saying, I'm in this rut and whatever, and I can't get out of it. And I'm just waiting for this, or I'm just waiting for that. I'm like, well, you're still going to be in the same place in 5 years if you're waiting. You're never going to, you can't wait for something to change. You know, you've got to change yourself. You've got to do something different if you want things to change. I think things are going to change by, and you're still repeating the same actions, having the same feelings, emotions day in, day out. So basically following your negative program, you can't expect anything to change. It's insanity to expect just like something to change one day if you don't change your behaviours or, you know, your routine, or, you know,
totally,
your environment. So
and so many people, so like there's so many, like Martin Bone gave a really good example last week, like so many people work in like such negative like environments, like you gave a good example where there's, and so many people who listen to this will be able to relate. It's like when someone says, oh, how are you doing, and then they go, well, at 4 o'clock I will be, because I'll be fucking out of here. Do you know what I mean? And so like that I suppose that's hard for, like, it, there's no easy answer to that. Like, how do people, like, you know, I suppose the easy answer is to leave your workplace if it's, you're surrounded by like negativity. Obviously it's not that easy, but like, you know, even just like, mate, I rocked up to work today. So I left Crosby Beach, went back home, had a shower, left, got a text from my missus saying, you've left the bath like there's been a fucking dog in it with the amount of sand.
Yeah.
And then I got to work, into the office at like 8 a.m. And I was flying. Like, I was flying. And you could see all the people who, like, you have that, like, that if you ever watch like a typical American film where there's like kids involved, they're like, they've got bagels in the hand, they're running, like, they're like trying to get the kids to school, like the kids are half dressed and like that rush. And like, this morning I just waltzed in and like
Tom just breezes in like a breath of fresh air.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, the mate, it was just I can't stop talking. I feel like we're just repeating this Crosby Beach this morning thing, but like we have so many people on this podcast and you hear various different opinions about, yeah, this works, you need to do this. Mm. And like until you actually do it and like go through it, you don't really believe it.
To the point where I was speaking to my mate Phil who wrote me book, good mate of mine, and I text him, he texted me, we had a little group chat and one of my mates come down. He texted me and said, must admit you've made me feel guilty there, because he spoke about potentially coming down. And he said, how was it? It looked good. And I texted him and I went, you know what, mate, I'll let me know when you can talk and I'll ring you. Because I felt like I couldn't get across on a text of like how good it was. Yeah. And he was like, I'm not right. I said, yeah, I can't text you. I said, lad, you need to experience this. And I was like, it's not the hardest workout I've done. It's not the thingy that I've, like, it wasn't the... I can't explain it. I said, it's like Martin said, you know, we're all seeking connection.
Yeah.
I'm out in the elements and all that.
I think what you find as well, a lot of it's like, I'm big on energy transfer. So like, say before I go in to work with the kids, for example, I've got certain motivational stuff, or I'll pull up outside 10 minutes before, close my eyes and listen to something that puts me in like a really like high frequency, so to say. So when I go in to work with the kids, they feed off that straight away. Mm. Where, you know, if I go in and I've been rushing, like you said before, and I'd stub my toe and whatever, and I go in, it's impossible for me to give them kids, like, you know, you could say good vibes, but it's impossible for them to feel great around me if I feel shit.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? So I purposely will put myself in, like, good spaces. This morning I'm dancing with my missus and me lad in the car with our favourite tunes on all the way there. But the minute I get out of bed on a Thursday morning, I'm straight onto my motivational stuff on my earphones while I'm getting my stuff ready, because I know that I've then got to go to that beach and transfer my energy to everyone who's on the beach, and I do me very, very best to do that. Do you know what I mean? So like, again, like you said before, when like the amount of I'm scared to go on Instagram or things today, but like I'm completely blown away by the amount of messages and like thank yous and things like that. And for me, that's like, there's a lot of gratification in that, because I know that what I've set out to do and what I am doing, like it's happening. And I know Martin's the same.
Mm.
Mark on a mission is exactly the same, you know.
I'll be honest, mate. I have to sound like, oh, like fucking, I've seen it all, but I have seen lads go through some horrendous injuries through Afghanistan and Iraq. I've got a lot of these friends who've got severely injured, life change injuries, and they're so inspirational. Some of the things they've done, from climbing Everest to rowing oceans and stuff, and I'm constantly I've been so inspired by them. And this isn't knocking any civilian, but it takes a lot for me to be inspired by someone or get a feeling of like, fucking hell, just because I've seen so many crazy feats of inspiration and motivation through service people that I'm with. But seeing that this morning, it gave me that same, like, this is fucking unreal, this. Mm. It genuinely was that powerful, like, where I think, like, it was just something that you couldn't really...
It's mad for me. So remember I told you we spent a week in Poland with Wim Hof?
Yeah.
When I came home from Poland, like, I went there with six, I won't even call them lads or friends, six of my brothers, we went there, and I came home that inspired to, like, and I'd have to tell you if they were here now, like, we spoke openly over making a difference in Liverpool when we came home, and I've had dreams of filling that beach full of people and walking them into cold water, like, months and months and months ago. And it's like, it was when I first came home, obviously it was probably one of the most motivated and inspired that I've ever been, like that, when you say over, finding it hard to express how like amazing an experience was. I was the same over that. I couldn't speak about it. People had asked me about it, and I just have to say, yeah, it was sand. But inside, like, if I was to try and explain to you how good it really was, I'd have your ear all day.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But like, what's going on the beach now, I've seen that happening already. That's like happened maybe 5-10 times in my mind. I've actually seen that, and like, you know, it's like, for it to actually be happening right now, when it's something what you've visualised and you've seen, and you know, it is like, it's for me, it's just confirmation. You can make anything happen if you can see it and you believe it, and you know, it can happen.
You said, like, obviously you get up every morning at 4:50 or 10 to 4. Is it that discipline, do you think, that is got you to where you are like with with like health, with wealth, with all of those three and happiness.
If you take health and wealth and everything out of it, happiness.
Yeah.
Like, I honestly believe I'm pound for pound one of the happiest people you'll ever meet in your life. Do you know what I mean? So it's not about money. Money doesn't make you happy. Like I said, there's people with fortunes who aren't happy. There's people with nothing, you know, financially, but are the happiest people you'll ever meet.
Mm.
What I've studied is self-development and learning about myself to learn what serves me, what doesn't, and then what doesn't, I get rid of it. And then what does empower me and make me feel better, make me happy, then obviously I want more of that.
Yeah.
And that's what I've spent like 8-9 years basically studying myself. Because this is already all in us. We're born happy, we're born.
Mm.
You know, you go and look at kids playing, kids are born happy, we're taught to be unhappy in our environment, what we live in. So it's like Martin will call it shedding layers. But these are just layers what you've attached to as you've been growing up, based on your environment. So for me, it's like learning about yourself to shed all the things which don't serve you. And you just come to a place where you're your true self. And I feel right now that through what's going on the beach and everything, what I'm doing, I'm just living my purpose, and there's no effort or nothing involved in it. It just happens. I just get up every morning and I don't have to think, like we spoke about setting goals and all that. I've done all that, but like I've got everything I want. I've got, I don't need nothing. I'm happy with everything what I've got. And like I've come to a realization that I've done that for myself through all these different methods and studying and putting myself around the right people. I just want to help everyone else basically get to where I am. That's like my mission. Through Awake, what I'm doing with the kids in the schools, it's like I need absolutely nothing. Like I'm blessed, grateful, and love my life, love the people in it. I'm surrounded by amazing people every day, all day. And I just want everyone to feel how I feel. And it's like, you know.
I think it's important though, mate, that, like, I don't know, you're giving, maybe you are, but it doesn't come across like you're giving yourself a pat on the back. Mate, this has come through, like you say, 8, 7, 8, 9 years of hard work, of being disciplined every morning. Do you know what
discipline
I mean?
Discipline is just the strongest, like the. Discipline is self-love. So it's like, if you know there's a lot of things what you should be doing, but you don't do them, but you know you should be doing them, then how can you be happy or feel worthy? Or, you know, if you know I should be eating better or I should be exercising. So for me, it's making a list. You know, you could do, I've done them in the past with friends and, you know, I've been struggling. I've given them self-feedback forms and I've literally sent them different people motivational videos, give them books to read, and give them 10 daily rituals to do for a week. And that daily rituals will always start with getting up in the morning at 5 o'clock, gratitude before you get out of bed, laying in bed for a couple of seconds and thinking of three things what you're grateful for. And then it goes from the same, pretty much I've set the blueprint for them of meditating for 10, 15 minutes. If you never meditated, just practice and learn every day. It's very hard. Meditation's like a lot more, it's a lot harder to meditate than it is for me to go and train for 2 hours in the gym. Meditation's hard, but it's a practice, and you will master it if you put the time and effort in. So it's like I've helped people with routine, because a lot of people are lost and that's where they struggle. They've got no daily routine, you know. They should be doing all these things and they're not doing them. But when you can give yourself a week and you can, you know, basically get a sheet of paper, and I might pass it to you, Tom, and it's got 10 things on for Tom to be Tom's very best, you know, is very, like operating and performing at his very best for 7 days. And it includes cold showers. It includes getting up at 5 o'clock. It includes exercising for an hour every day, eating healthy. So if you work your way through that list and at the end of the week, you've scored 70, 10 a day, you've scored 70 out of 70. There's no, you know, you've given your best. There's no more you can do.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? And when you're at that point where you know you're constantly and consistently giving your best, there's no more you can do, you know. Whatever happens, happens. You're in control of yourself, and by following all them rituals and designing a program which betters your life, if you know you're committed to it and you're sticking to it, then whatever happens, happens. It's like if you've got no control over outside events, you can't stress over.
You put yourself in the best possible position, haven't you, for them?
You just don't, it's like going into a fight knowing at the end of the day I've committed to my training, my diet. I've given 110%. If you lose, you lose. Don't get me wrong, you will be disappointed. But it hurts a lot less knowing that you give everything and you've lost, as opposed to going into a fight knowing that you've cut corners and then you've lost the fight and you've got a reason why. Do you know what I mean? So you've got a reason why. So yeah, beat yourself up and be angry at yourself. Rightly so, you should. But if you've committed 110% to a fight or whatever it is, and you've lost, something outside of your control has happened, then it is what it is. You just get over it, you live and learn, and you go again. Do you know what I mean?
Mm.
Is it right, mate, to say that you will? I was quite far away, but mate, you seem quite emotional. And this morning, like after it, with your mum and stuff, and
yeah.
What was nice, mate, was seeing you emotional, seeing that kind of, you know. And I think it was good for everyone, mate, because you know, obviously, fucking MMA fighter, it's fucking you know, wouldn't want to fucking slap off you, and you're this fella, and you're showing your emotion like that. I think that was important in itself, yeah. Just because again,
Martin kind of last week put a video on, he'd been in awake in the morning, and to actually come in and for me to see Martin, I really, really respect and look up to Martin, and the knowledge and the passion for what he's got and what he does is like, is completely out of this world. And he came into awake last week as a student and done a morning class. So it's like, imagine seeing like someone who you really respect in that environment, because that's his environment. He's the king of that environment in my eyes. So to come in and be there as a student and come out, he actually put a video on Instagram of himself emotional. So and for me that's a powerful thing. It's only really if you stop yourself from crying again, that's only your ego caring what other people thinking. I think I'm at a point now where obviously I want to be an example for other people, and if I'm going to hold my feelings back because I care about what other people think, then you know, I'm not being true to myself, and that's not what I'm about, you know what I mean?
Mm. Mate, where did all this come about? Like, how did Mark Scano sort of like start this? Like,
yeah, that was one of the questions we got asked someone. Said, what was the turning point? What was the bit where you kind of said, right, you know what, I need to start, you know, working on me. I need to. Was there like,
to be honest, like all the stuff I speak about in terms like frequencies, vibrations? People say law of attraction, but really it's the law of vibration. That's all. That's all studied. It's actual science. It's not like I won't say I'm the least religious person, but I've never read a Bible, any type of religious book in my life, and I never used to believe in any way I was spiritual. But like I've mentioned on the last podcast, I met a guy called Brian McCready, who's like an encyclopedia of knowledge when it comes to psychology and neurology and quantum physics and all the things what I study daily now. And he just explained things to me in the most simple way possible, and everything just made sense. So it was like, he literally just opened the can of worms for me, and I just started delving into it more. And like before...
Did you never really thought about any of this beforehand and stuff? I'd
always been curious, and I'd been open-minded, in the sense that, like, I knew there was something out there, but I didn't know what it was. Like, I knew it weren't just me going about my daily life, and you know, is the aliens up there? Well, obviously there's got to be aliens up there somewhere. Is there a God? Well, I don't know. I don't want to say there isn't, but I don't believe it's a fella up there with a beard who says, yeah, you can come in, or no, you've been naughty, you can't. Do you know what I mean? So I was always curious and asked a lot of questions, even to myself. But I think I was that obsessed and caught up in fighting. That was like my life, so I never really had time to go into it or think about it so much, because I was obsessed, and fighting was my thing, and I loved it. But at the time of meeting Brian, I was coming away from fighting, and he just and going more into like business and work and stuff like that. And the stuff what he taught me within the first couple of conversations, and then obviously I started exploring, delve into it more. I looked right back through my whole life and could see different like times where I was. Like an example is when I've been in a negative place or in a bad place, so to say, it was because of my way of thinking. I weren't in a bad place. My way of thinking weren't negative because I was in a bad place. It's the opposite way around. I was putting myself in a bad place because where my mind was, and maybe the people I was surrounding myself with and my environment at the time. So this is just the process of starting to study yourself and learn about yourself. And then I'd look back to like when I was growing up, and like I said this morning, you can literally have anything, you know. I'm not saying it's like, it's not easy, and a lot of the time there is hard work involved, but like, you really can, if you commit to it and you believe in it, you know, you can do whatever you want. If I wanted to be a doctor in 10 years, I'd start now and I'd study being a doctor every day, and in 10 years I'd be a doctor. Do you know what I mean? People get caught up in like the 9-to-5 jobs and whatever else, and you say, I can't do that, you know, by the time I get out of work at 6 o'clock and whatever, but you don't have to listen to like Arnold Schwarzenegger or someone like that, his story, and you say, well, you know, you finish work at 6 o'clock, you've got till midnight to study, and that's my belief. If you want something bad enough,
yeah,
you'll figure out a way to do it. So I started studying, like, it started with law of attraction, which obviously led into energies and frequencies and vibrations. And when I started to understand that, I looked at back at times in my life. So, like, I've always had that little entrepreneur thing. I was making more money than my mum when she was working when I was in school, selling sweets. And my mum, you see my mum, she's a scouse mum. So, like, I had my mum in the summer, I'd come up to the school on dinner times, and you weren't allowed to sell sweets in school, but you'd be passing me big carrier bags of freezies over the over the fence. So I'd be getting these bags of freezies off my mum. My mum had a proper hustle in school, walking on the school yard. And by the time I'd emptied my bag and gone back, she'd be there again with another bag of freezies. You know what I mean? And I just had, like, a major, like, so selling sweets, and always, like, then I go back even further to when I remember we used to live in these masonettes, and I obviously didn't have much money. So sweets and money for the shop was, like, you know, didn't happen every day. But I'd literally come out of ours, and if I wanted sweets out the shop, I'd walk up and down the road, I'd be going in phone boxes, and, like, I'd always find money and end up in the shop. And it's little things like that, what, like, once I started to learn about all this.
It seems like you're always striving from an early age.
I look back and I think, like, you know, I bought my own Rockport in school, and all my mates had Rockport. My mum couldn't afford them. She'd done her best. She bought me kickers, but all my mates had Rockport. Like, okay, so how do I get Rockport? And it's like, well, I'll go and buy sweets out of the shop for £1, and I'll double up, and I'll go on with £2, and then tomorrow I'll buy £2 worth. And eventually I was, like, the main man in school. It was like a walk and tuck shop with the assistance of my mum. And it's literally,
they should allow that in schools, you know. They should allow it, you know, because it creates people like yourself. Do you know what I mean? That whole, you know.
It's school rules are rules, aren't they? But basically, I just started to look back over my whole life once I started to learn all these things and think, like, well, that's why that happened, and that's why that happened. And a lot of things which I'd never actually thought about started to come to me and make sense. So once you get to that point and you're realising that, you know, you literally can attract and manifest and create things, but, you know, they don't just come from nowhere. You can't become a millionaire by sitting on the couch going, I'm going to become a millionaire, I'm going to become a millionaire. If you don't move off that couch, you're not going to become a millionaire. But if you do believe that you can do that, then your actions, your behaviours, your routine, your habits will start to change.
The good thing as well, mate, about that thing on the beach and what you're saying, like, it was like a little motivational talk at the end. I like saying, is he fucking after my job there or something? Like, your little talk at the end, it was great. But I think what you've hit the nail on the head with there, saying it's not as if you're sitting on a couch, I'm sitting on my couch and I ring you up and you go, right, Andy, you know, you can achieve anything you want to achieve. You just gotta, it's all right doing that. But the fact that everyone's there, they've made an effort, they've got out the comfort zone, they're on the beach, they've just done a workout, they've done meditation, they've got in the water, they're meeting like-minded people, they're surrounded those good vibrations, and then they're getting told you can achieve anything. Fuck me, that takes your message, fucking blows it up, doesn't it?
Yeah, I've had messages off people today, literally saying how they got emotional. And
I was nearly crying, and I went, and I was emotional, and everyone went, oh, fucking hell, no, yeah.
But it's self-limiting beliefs what we're taught by our environment. So up until 7 years of age, you're basically operating in a state called theta. So you've got different brain states. Theta is what a hypnotist will put you into to try and change your behaviour, or, you know, they put you under. So theta, up until seven, you're in a state of theta, which means you're downloading your environment, because that's what happens when you get hypnotised. They basically download, you know, if you smoke, they'll download that you don't smoke, so to say. So up until seven, you're in a state of theta. And basically what you're doing is downloading your environment. So things what you see, like I said on the last podcast, over, like, your parents can say things totally unintentionally. You know, they don't want to spoil the kid, so they're like, no, you can't have that, it costs too much money. But how you wear these things to kids is massively important, because basically you're teaching your child while he's in a theta state, lack. That lack is normal. Do you know what I mean? So then your child after seven, that creates a worldview. They've got that till the day they die. So if you teach your child in the first 7 years that lack is normal, then unless they go and get hypnotized or something, you know, something happens as they're growing up, that's going to be their belief, and it's limiting beliefs. And unfortunately, we do get a lot of these from our parents, and they got them from their parents. And, you know, we can go back and ancestors and whatever. So again, like, we're awake. It's like, if you're bringing kids in, you're trying to kind of, you know, break fucking generational curses, so to say, by changing their beliefs and teaching them that. Like Lizzie, that's what she does with Best Self Club, what we spoke about before.
Yeah,
she's getting kids and teaching them law of attraction. You know, because they are kids, you can't really go totally into the science behind it, but you don't need to teach kids the science behind it because
it's the language, isn't it?
It's just the language, mate. Yeah, if you can translate it to kids in a way that they understand and they implement it. You know, if you get kids up until 7 years of age believing like they can do anything, then they've got that for the rest of their life, and they're the kids who are successful. Do you know what I mean? So you get kids who go to school with loads of self-limiting beliefs, but they work hard in school and they come out with every qualification under the sun, but they end up in like a, you know, I won't say a dead end job, but they end up doing something that they don't enjoy, not doing the job which they've just studied for and they've got every qualification and entitled to do, but they don't do it because basically they're not programmed to be able to achieve it. Do you know what I mean? Bob Proctor is another guy who I definitely recommend anyone to study Bob Proctor, because he's one of the first people I watched, and he talks a lot about self-image paradigms and cybernetics, and they're basically another word for your program. So everyone is living in a program. I'm living in a program, but the difference with me is because I practice meditation and self-development, I design a program which fits my life, which adds growth to my life and value, and I'm aware of things again through meditation that don't fit where I want to be and who I want to be, and obviously I get rid of them, you know, self-limiting beliefs and stuff like that. Through understanding and studying these things, I'm like, well, that I can recognize what a self-limiting belief is and something which maybe, you know, I need to fix if I want to progress or become a better person. And that's when repetition becomes part of it then. So it's understanding and learning that maybe my self-talk's negative or I'm complaining. Well, the awareness that I'm doing it is the start. That's what meditation teaches you, just self-awareness, to be familiar with your thoughts and yourself. And obviously by becoming aware of them, you can start to change them. So if you're complaining or in general, you start to become aware of your thoughts, you're like, shit, I'm a lot more negative than what I thought it was.
Then you're in a position to start to change. It's like when you said about in the last podcast about that kid, and you ask him how he's doing and he says, oh, it's shit, innit?
Yeah, see what's happening, and they go, fuck all, it's shit, innit? And I go, not for me, mate, it's amazing. Why is it shit? And they go, I go, you need to watch what you say, you know you're in the ION program, don't you? They go, yeah. I go, do you know what that means? And they go, well, no, and they look at me like I've got two heads or something, and I'll explain it to them and translate it in a way what they understand. For as much as I've studied and I know a lot of like the big words, and I can go into it a lot more, I'm able to translate it and put it across to kids in a way that they understand and they can relate to me, and then obviously use it themselves, because like I said last time, the next week I'll come in and go, what's happening, how are you? And they start laughing and say, yeah, everything's boss, and I guarantee they don't just say that to me. Do you know what I mean? They might see the mates, and hopefully when they're around the mates say to them what's happening, they go, nothing, not much, which is better than saying, fuck all, it's shit.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So
it's like you said before the podcast, that what you're doing there at the beach and that kind of whole synergy, what was it when you, do you reckon one good deed,
the
ripple?
So there's a thing called, it's basically called the ripple effect. So an example I'll use is if you drop a stone in a pond, obviously it ripples out, doesn't it? And there's a statistic I read a few years ago, and basically it says if you do one good deed or one goodwill gesture to someone in the morning, so you basically make someone feel happy in the morning. That's why it's so important in the morning, because if you do it at 7 o'clock in the night, it's going to impact less people before they go to bed.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So if someone goes to bed at 10 o'clock, you've got a 3-hour window there where they're going to obviously do something nice for someone else. But like I say to Tom in the morning, yeah, I'm driving to work and you're driving to work, and there's loads of cars behind me, and I stop and I let you go, and you're like, mate, thank you very much. And then you get to the next junction and someone else is there, and you stop and let them go, and then they go into work and see someone in work who maybe necessarily they don't know, they wouldn't normally say hello to, and they go, because they're in a good mood, hiya mate, you're okay. And it literally does, you know, even if it was 25% of 2,000 people, if one good deed in the morning can affect 500 people a day. Look what me, Martin and Mark are doing on the beach every Thursday.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
You know, it's literally changing the vibration of Liverpool, and that's our mission. That's what, when I say it's our mission, it's like, there's no effort involved. So I'm not asking 500 people to come to the beach on a Thursday morning, and neither's Martin. We're just letting them know it's there, and we're creating a space for them to come, to gather with a load of other like-minded people who all want to improve. And it's just happening. There's no, like I said, it's not like we're trying or we're...
No one's going there, getting dragged and screaming there, mate.
No. And do you know what, mate, even if they are, unless you physically pull someone out of bed and get them there, they've got there themselves. So I did say that this morning, every single person who's there, I've got a lot of admiration and respect for them, because for me it's normal. But for a lot of them people, they're not used to getting out of bed at 8 or 9 o'clock.
Mm.
So for them to make a commitment and get out of bed at 4:30, there was a lady who came over as soon as I got there, come over and give me a hug and said I drove an hour to get here from Bolton.
Wow.
Do you know what I mean?
From Bolton?
From Bolton, mate. A woman drove from Bolton to the beach this morning and came marched straight over.
That is incredible, that.
I've drove here an hour to be here. Thank you very much. Do you know what I mean? So I'm not just having a ripple effect in Liverpool, it's having a ripple effect. There might be a few happy people in Bolton today.
What a special feeling that is, though, mate, knowing that something that you've put on or something that you've been a part of. Mate, I didn't even, you know, this is your gig, and even I feel like that's fucking, everyone there has had an impact on that lady.
But everyone there plays a part, because it's not just me, I'm not charging everyone, everyone's charging each other.
Mm.
You know, like I said, I can get myself in the best place possible, because I'm big on energy transfer. And if I go there in a negative frame of mind, I'm going to be no use to no one. So I put myself in my happy place, get there, have a little boogie and do a circuit and everyone over to Martin. And it's like the contrast as well from going from like a physical circuit and actual, we call it a combat circuit because it's punching and kicking and knees and, you know, to go on to do what Martin does. I think it's definitely we hit a sweet spot, so to say.
Massively, yeah.
You know, how it makes people feel. And again, that's like the mornings and a week. I've designed a class called High Frequency Fitness, and it's 20 minutes hit, like a circuit type, straight into yoga, straight into meditation at the end. And like my mission again with that is to send people to work every morning. If I get 150 people in from Monday to Friday, walking out of that place in the morning, trained, exercised, meditated, got a big fucking thing like greens, juices, all healthy, basically send them out happy and healthy, then that has a ripple effect in Liverpool, and that's like, for me, that's worth more than money or anything else.
This podcast will be going out on the day today, a week's opening today. Mm. So how does it work? Is it a kind of like a membership thing? You just pop in? Is it like... What,
yeah, it's...
Because that's all I've been asked, mate. Fucking hell, everyone. How does it work? How do you...
What's going to happen is the last week of every month, we're going to open a week window where you book your sessions for the next month, because it is in such high demand. It's going to be like first come, first serve on the sessions, but you'll just pay for, you know, maybe you might pay for a block of 10 sessions for that month. Well, you'll book your sessions in the last week of, say it was January, the last week of January, you book all the February sessions in.
Mm-hmm.
We've got 6 a.m. classes, which is obviously win your morning, win your day. You've got your 10 a.m. for the mums and dad who've just dropped the kids off at school and whatever. We've got a 6 p.m. and we've got a 7:30 p.m. then. We've got 6 classes a week, 4:30 every night, which is just free for kids. So basically we fund the kids classes from the adults classes, and these Monday to Friday there's a class every night, Saturday there's a class, and there'll probably be a class Sunday as well. And wow, like I said last time, no child will ever pay for any service what we provide or any classes or. And then on top of that, the company I'm involved with, Crossfield Exclusive, you know, the developments company,
mm-hmm.
I sat down with them and told them what my plan, I really went into detail, and my friends and business partners, but I told them exactly what I'm doing in depth not so long ago, and they're in the middle of like basically sourcing a unit at the south end of Liverpool. They're going to fully kit it out for me, and we do these digital detoxes.
I'm on the next one.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
Yeah, you're on it. Yeah.
So, I'm coming,
so we advertised yesterday for 140 people, and it's a free day out, and it's about connecting people. So there's no mobile devices, there's no iPads. He's not on you. Literally, I stand at the front of the bus. I'm like the inspector.
Head pat teacher.
You
down.
Metal detectors. Make sure you're not getting on the bus with any mobiles or no devices. Take them all off you. Put a sticker on with your name on it. Goes in my box at 8:30 in the morning. And you will not get it back until 6 o'clock in the night. I'll take you into nature. Mick Kieran's one of the top mountain guides in the country. So I've got probably 20, 30 assistant guards lined up for the next walk. And we've got 140 people going out on 270-seater coaches, just in nature. Just, you know, I won't say where it is, because it's always, I sell it like it's a secret location. I won't tell you where you're going. I'll tell you what you need a week before, but you'll just turn up at a week. I'll just ask you to be fully present with your family, with your kids, make new friends, mingle, mix, you know, like building that sense of community on the day. And we just take it out for the day. And we done one a couple of days before lockdown came in. And like, we couldn't have timed it any better. And again, like the beach in the morning, you've just never seen so many grateful people not wanting the phones back at the end of the day.
You know what's so special about that, mate? You speak about like the work you're doing with kids in a way, having free classes, how it's so important. I was Mate, I feel like you're my fucking biggest fanboy ever, mate, but I've been telling people about you. And my dad was one of them, and I was saying to my dad when I was walking the dog, when I got booked on the digital detox, I said, oh, fucking, I'm made up, I got on this place. Mm. My sister's coming, and on one of them, I said, I'm taking Megan with me. And he said, well, how much is that? I was like, it's nothing. I said, this fella just takes you out and gets you off your phone for the day. And he was like, and do what? I said, you don't. And I was just going through this idea.
Yeah.
My dad's 55 and he just could not get his head around. I'm like,
but you might find your daddy's not on Instagram all day and being on a phone 24/7, not even a thing to them. Do you know what I mean? It's only a thing to a lot of us, because we do know that all of us at times are guilty of scrolling nonsense on your phone. And
I just love that kind of how it seems like so unnatural, but to me, daddy was like, he just couldn't believe, and I think that's where you come from, the kind of vibrations and the wanting to give back and stuff. It just creates this, like, wow, it creates a change in the city, it creates a change that people aren't used to. It's like, it's sad, isn't it, but people aren't used to going, hang on, there's a fella there who's got this boss idea, who's going to get a couple of coaches and it's going to fund 100 odd people to go away for the day and connect with each other and make new friends. That's not normal. It'd be great if it was, but unfortunately it's not.
But for me, it's trying to make that become normal, because it is, because I get messages every day, people, not necessarily in finance or in any way, people just want to get involved and help and support us. And like I said, it's people who just work normal jobs, and you know, it's not, a lot of them, all they have to offer is the time, and you know, that's the most valuable thing. So to me, it means a lot, because I probably, if I went back through my messages and stuff on my phone, there's hundreds and hundreds of people who were just like, Mark, what you're doing is, you know, fucking great, and we'd love to get involved and help you in some way. And I've got like an unlimited supply of like help.
Resources.
And you know, and that's what it's about. It's like, people aren't selfish in general, but everyone's kind of in their own day-to-day life, and that's the most important thing in the world to them. But once you open a door or you show someone something, it is... No, you can use the word inspiring people, but it's not. It's just showing someone something. It's just, again, everything's information. It's like, you know, you're showing someone that they don't need loads of money to go and help someone. Or, you know, for the development company where I'm involved in, we do a lot of charity work anyway. So for me, it's about just, like, I like to, in some of my time when I'm on my own and I'm watching my motivational stuff, I'll be like thinking, I'll be seeing problems that I know. So like there's a fella, Jocko Wilco, who I watch some of his stuff,
and loads of us,
Jocko's basically saying, take ownership of your problems, take ownership of this and take ownership of that. And I'm like, well, for me, I want to take ownership of some of the problems that I see for other people and create and manifest ways to make that better for them, to add value to their lives. Because like I said, I feel like I've got absolutely everything. My life's perfect in every way, so it's like, I don't need nothing. So where'd you go from? You don't need nothing. Well, the only missing link in my life, and again, I relate this to a lot of fighters who've achieved everything, what they wanted to achieve, sportsmen who've been successful, that missing link is always the service to others, because at the end of the day, that's what we're all supposed to be doing anyway. That the truest form of anything is adding value to other people's lives.
But that's just highlighted as well in what you're saying, where you look, you know, you started doing this good thing for people, and the amount of people who are like, can I help? It's in us all.
Everyone wants to do it. Everyone wants to.
But you just need that little. Like me this morning saying, "Oh, I'm a winner." It's like you just need that little push to go, look, yeah, you can help. You can do something.
That's through self-study. So that's through me literally studying self-development for years and years, from watching videos, from reading books. It's like all the greats, they all served other people. Like Jim Rohn, I said to you last time, a famous saying is, do more than what you paid for, and then sooner or later you'll be paid for more than what you're doing. Again, that's like, people always think like they've got to get something back to do something, but they don't see it in, you know, just keep doing and keep giving, and it'll come back anyway, because it's an energy exchange. It might come as money. Money's energy, everything's energy, we're all energy. So, you know,
I have done that with speaking gigs, you know, mate. There's fellas in business and stuff, and I said, look, I'll come and do it, then you can pay me for whatever you think it's worth.
Yeah,
I've done things like that before.
I'm big on that myself, because they're then dictating what that value of the service, what you provided to them, is worth. And you can actually gain more from doing that, because if you provide someone with an amazing service, people don't do themselves justice. So it's like, you know, I could say in a week I want £50 a session, you know, because people are going to come out of there. People have come out of there crying in the morning with emotion, feeling so happy and grateful.
Yeah.
Do you mean what? You know, at the end of it, it's not about that.
Yeah, yeah.
But there's people who'd happily pay that. You know, you name your own worth, your own value.
Yeah.
You know, for me, it's about creating enough money to make it sustainable as a business. And no matter what, if I start any business, my goal is always for it to be successful, and it will earn money. But at the same time, it deserves to earn money because what we're giving back to
what you were telling to me, especially, mate, said the last time, and I felt like, you know, not a fraud, but you think like I'm making money from speaking, but you said a line and it was like, if you can find a way to make money by giving back, then that's
mate, the cigarette thing. Companies, ale companies, fucking food companies earn billions off killing people. What the fuck's wrong with going and earning a few quid, adding value and making people healthy and happy?
Yeah, so true.
So you can't feel guilty for doing it. If you're giving someone your very best, 100% of your energy and a great service and adding value, making them happy, making them healthy, then you deserve something back. It's like it's a lot of compensation, it's called. Do you know what I mean? You're getting compensated for what you're giving out. And again, that's Bob Proctor show, but you know, that's what it is. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. So. Wait, we like on that point, like, especially this morning, there was a few kids there and certainly myself. It's like you get to understand that, like, with success, I feel that, like, you, like, anyone, like you said it at the end, like, anyone can do what I've done. And, like, it's so reassuring for people of, like, from single parents, from, you know, kids that haven't grown up with dads or whatever it might be, that you give your ultimate and you give your all and you can become whatever you want. And, like, success, ultimately, you provide a product or service to someone who wants it to, or who wants to buy that product or service, and that might be your employment to a company. You know, you provide a good product or service and people will come and buy it and pay for it, and you'll become successful. Not obviously, maybe not through monetary ways, but other ways.
Yeah.
And like, it just hits home with so many people. I think that, like, you know, when your mum got up before at the start, like, I know we keep talking about the Crosby Beach, but like, it's just like, even I thought to myself, like, you know, I'm lucky, you know, when I was younger, I went to like a really good school, like it was a paying school, private school. But like, there's so many, if I look at other people, there's so many other people who are younger than me that you could class are more successful than me. And it's like literally success, the market doesn't give a fuck which school you went to. If your parents are divorced, if you live in, you know, Old Swan or wherever, it doesn't give a fuck. All it cares about is, do you provide a product or service that people want to buy? Simple as that.
And then it's finding what your product or your service is, what you enjoy and what you love.
Yeah.
You know, if you can find someone what you love, it's not about earning a lot of money. You know, use a teacher for an example. A teacher might earn, I haven't got a clue what a teacher earns, but say they earn £40,000 a year teaching, and they love teaching, you know, then they're successful, massively successful.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're going to get a bin man, so to say. A lot of people stereotype a bin man and think, well, that's not a very good job. Bin men earn decent money. But, you know, you get the bin men who are people persons, and they know every single fucking person who's been the empty, and they say hello every morning, and, you know, they've got a roof over their head, they've got food, they've got weekends with the kids, evenings with the missus, and, you know, everyone's definition of success is different, but my definition of success is doing what you enjoy doing and earning a living from it. You know what I mean? Doing something where you could earn millions doing something what you hate, that's not success. That's the ultimate failure for me. Because you've got all that money and you can have everything and you're still not happy.
I can't remember whether we spoke about it on the last podcast, and if we did, stop me, but about the one where the two guys go fishing. And did we speak about it on the last one?
Yeah, Chinese fish.
And one of them comes back early.
Yeah.
Did we speak about that, did we?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, but that's one of my great things.
Was that on the Joe Rogan podcast with Dan Bilzerian?
I've heard it a few times. I've read it recently. It must have been before or after the last one. Basically, dead quick for anyone who didn't hear it, it's, you know, two fishermen go out and one of them catches enough fish for the day and he goes to go home. And then this, like, American fisherman comes over and he's like, you know, straight away just sees pound signs and he's like, where are you going? He's like, well, I've caught me fish for the day and, you know, going to go back with my family and enjoy the things, you know, what make me happy and stuff. He's like, no, you should keep fishing. Then you can earn this amount of money. Then you can go back and you can buy a bigger boat. And you can come back and then you can do that. And then you can do this and do that and do that. And he plans out the next, like, 50 years of his life. And he says, and then, you know, when you've got all your money, you know, then you can go and spend time with your family. And fellow was like, but that's what I'm going to do now. like, I'm going to enjoy the things I want to do now. And it was just, it's a great little story. It's a bit more complicated than that, but it's that thing of, you got to enjoy what you do, and it's not about money.
No.
It's not. And in this story, the guy's going, well, if you earn 10 fish instead of 2, you can buy a bigger boat and you can earn 10 times as much money, and then you can do that and do that. Just all about the money. And then the other fisherman's like, look, I'll get me fish that I need to sell. That makes me money for that. And I've got me plan, and I spend time with my family, and I love my job, and I love this, and I love that, and I'm happy, and it's getting to that level.
I don't think anyone can be truly happy without the work-life balance, do you know what I mean? Mm. So it's like you can... I honestly believe if I wanted to be a billionaire, but would I be happy? No, because I wouldn't see my kids, I wouldn't see my missus, I wouldn't be able to train twice a day. I'd have to be obsessed with, you know, with money.
Mm-hmm.
And like that's, you know, I'd have to obsess about it, and that wouldn't make me happy. You know, I'm at a point now where things are going well with work, and but I've got like that, I have got the balance where I do get to spend time with my kids, I get 2 hours working on myself every morning. I've surrounded myself with amazing people. You know, I've got like best mates who's been my best mate and work with me, and like everyone I'm around is like fucking awesome boss people.
Was there a time where you didn't have that work-life balance, or?
Well, I'd say pretty much over the last 8-9 years from coming away from fighting, I've obviously had to commit a lot of time to work, so I definitely didn't spend as much time with my son as what I'd have liked to, but you know, I was having to go from fighting and earn a bit of money from fighting and coaching into, you know, basically just starting again. So, you know, that was quite tough, but, you know, it's got me to where I am now. And, you know, it's one of them, because if you've got no money at the end of the day and you want to live a certain life and you believe that you can and you know that you can, then you've got to put the work in. It's like, you have different things in your life. So say you've got obviously work and business, you've got your family, you've got obviously yourself and your own happiness. You know, there might be like 4 things. It's trying to keep that constant, like, you know, if you give too much to work, then the balance is going to be out with, say, your wife. You know, if you give too much time with your wife, then you're not going to be able to earn no money. So again, it's just constantly evaluating, giving yourself feedback on where you are. Like, again, like I said, over the ritual sheets and stuff like that, you can look at the end of the week and score yourself on a scale of 1 to 10, well, how much effort have I put in work, how much time have I given my wife, how much energy have I put in with the kids, and you can assess it from there, and I guarantee they'll never all be 10.
No.
Do you know what I mean? It's impossible.
I guess that comes into having a goal then as well, doesn't it? You know, you're making those sacrifices because you know you've got your goal.
There's been times in my life where obviously being in work, I've had to take time away from what I'd have spent with, say, my wife and my son, because I've had to put that time and energy into earning a living. But then, you know, you always know that it's not going to be forever. I'm not going to be out from 5 in the morning coming home at 12 o'clock in the night forever. I'm doing that for a period of time to get me to where I need to be. Do you know what I mean? So it's, you know, it's a constant juggling act, and you're always trying to find the right balance. You know, I have it at times, and at times I don't. There's times where maybe I'm not giving me missus and the kids as much time and energy as what I'd like to, but that's because I'll have different projects and different things going on with work, and it's just constantly, like again, when you go back to meditation and stuff, it's awareness, so you're constantly talking, like I'm speaking to myself, having conversations with Mark Scanlon pretty much every day, and trying to assess where I am with things. And you know, if you can be completely honest with yourself, you find a lot of the time if you're not getting on with your missus, so to say, in my case, I know it's because I've been putting too much time and energy into other things. So where maybe years ago they'd been like, well, she should do this and she should do that and whatever, I'm like, well, if I'm totally honest and I'm looking, I go, well, why aren't we getting on so well? I've got to ask myself a question. Am I giving her all the time and energy what she deserves? And if, you know, these times where maybe you can't give them all the time and the energy what they deserve, and they're not going to be happy, but is it justified by you're actually using that time and energy into work?
Yeah,
you know, maybe you've got to be in a doghouse for a few days basically to make sure that a project or something, what you're doing, goes where you need it to go. So it's like
that, mate. That literally goes on to your intentions. I remember asking you on the last podcast, and you were so right. You said, you know, I said, how do you kind of get rid of kind of negativity and get these great people in your life? And you kind of said it just happens by doing, and already from. So silly, but like from speaking to you the week, I said to you, mate, you feel like a fire's been lit again, and I'm getting like cold showers, and then I've got like new friends now, I'm speaking to new people just off like literally conversations, or people have listened to the podcast, and you think, and I asked Mark this last week, and then suddenly by just having a different frame of mind and doing things differently and getting out of old habits, you see kind of, you know, you might not speak to that person as much, or you might not, doesn't mean you don't like them or nothing, but, and then someone else might pop into your life and you're like, oh, someone else is great. And
yeah, there's a lot of people who are lonely, and I've had messages of people say, look, I feel like I'm around negative people, but don't really know anyone positive. You get people saying, I want to come and spend time with you, and I'm like, I haven't got time. I've got my own family and my own stuff, and I need to be around people like you. And I'm like, you don't, you just need to work on yourself. So you might have to be lonely for 12 months, but in that 12 months, commit to working on yourself, raising your own vibration, and you'll just start to attract the right people, because the better you become, people are drawn to you, and you're drawn to like-minded, similar people. Positive 100%. Frequency and negative frequency doesn't go, they're the opposites. And like I said in the last one, if you go and get a couple, so to say, and they're both really negative, and all they do is complain, they get on like a house on fire. But you know, if maybe fucking the husband bangs his head and something happens to him and he wakes up and he's Mr. Positive, you know, they won't get on. They just won't.
No.
She'll do his head in and he'll do her head in. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. That was one of the questions actually, mate, and it feeds in perfectly what you're saying there about people being lonely. It's like someone said, do you think people crave human connection more than ever now due to the rapid rise of social media?
Yeah.
There is, isn't it?
Yeah, because a lot of the media is filled with negativity and, you know, basically designed to put you in a bad place. That's the most simple way I can explain it. The media and the news is designed to make you feel like shit. Fact. Do you know what I mean? Go and get a farmer in a farmer's field who hasn't got a telly. He wouldn't even know this pandemic was going on. He'd be happy as Larry, just cracking on, doing whatever he's doing.
Mate, yeah, that's a point, actually, because I remember I don't know if it was you, Andy, but someone had said, like, there was a, I think it was in Afghan, and these farmers hadn't even, they didn't know why the troops were there. They didn't even know about 9/11. They hadn't got a clue.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, mate,
and it's all different. You don't have to be on a farmer's field. Like, you can just stop watching the news.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, it's that simple. It's
so funny you say about the news, mate. I remember fucking, and this happened, it was a news article a couple of weeks ago, so it didn't get like main headlines. But you know, for years and years, there's been this thing of like overpopulation. There's too many humans and, you know, fucking the world, it's overpopulation. I seen a news article the other day. It said there's not enough people being born in these countries. It's like, hang on, so you've managed to put a negative spin on too many people, and now you somehow put a negative spin on there's not enough people. It's fucking,
I mean, 99% of the news is negative. So the key for me is there's information in the news which can be useful and resourceful, but it's being able to take that information without getting emotionally involved in it. So, you know, when all this pandemic thing was coming about, I found myself drawn, because there's different stuff going on and working it, but, you know, can affect you financially and everything else. The sickness side of things, I don't worry over getting sick in any way. I just don't. If I got corona tomorrow, I'd still go to the gym. Do you know what I mean? You'd have to literally, I'd do everything what I do on a daily basis, no matter how I felt. Like, you know, unless I was in a hospital bed, I'd still be on that cross trainer, that treadmill, the wrong machine in the morning, being positive videos on. So the sickness side of things didn't really bother me, but because I wanted updates and wanted to know what was going on, I did find myself watching the news. I've never watched the news in like 10 years. Even when I was fighting, I never watched the news. But I did find myself getting caught up in that little thing, and for the first time for as long as I can remember, I was getting feelings of anxiety and a little bit of uncertainty and stuff like that. So, and that's me, with the knowledge where I've got and the stuff that I've studied and the self-awareness and where I am right now. So
it's probably reassuring for a lot of people to know that you've just said that.
Yeah, but I can't imagine where, like, you know, there's elderly people now, institutionalised.
Mate, I've got a friend
because
that
they won't move out the house because they watch the news and take every single thing. I was like, you know,
mate, I think a lot of, like, as soon as the schools started closing, I think, like, everyone was like, Jesus, because no one's ever been through it, so, you know.
I've got a friend and her mum, she's moving out, she's getting a flat now near Sefton Park, because her mum essentially just won't leave the house there's, like, a vaccine, and she won't be,
And the vaccines, you know, do we know that the vaccines are safe, or?
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it?
The strongest thing to boost your immune system is your own mind. You know, it's being healthy and happy. So, like, one of the things what I was going to speak about is, you know, ill thoughts create illness. So if you focus on sickness, so at the minute, right in the news, everything's sickness, sickness, corona, corona. There's plenty of people getting sick, but they're not getting corona. They're just manifesting and creating sickness in their own body because they're focusing on sickness all day, every day, watching the news and speaking about it and working, and they're making themselves sick. There's, so the opposite of that is what we're doing on the beach and what we're doing with a week. I'm just trying to create happiness in people because, as deep as it sounds, it saves people's lives. It stops people getting diseases. So, like we were speaking before, the podcast over, there's like different guys who study. There's Bruce Lipton.
Go into the science, mate, because that was dead interesting.
So there's three guys. There's Bruce Lipton, Joe Dispenza and Greg Braden, the people who have studied and have been to seminars and stuff. So basically what they tell you is you're either in a state of growth or a state of survival. A state of survival is like you're in fight or flight. So imagine when you're nervous or you're scared and you get them butterflies in your gut. That's basically because your body's transferring all your energy to your arms and legs. And the science behind it is if you go back to when we were cavemen, the only time we'd ever feel fear or nervousness or them butterflies is when we were in danger. So you imagine you're fucking going through the jungle and you're trying to catch a tea. Well, you know, there's a very good chance that a saber-toothed tiger's going to jump out of the bushes and eat you. Mm. So you're in a heightened sense of, like, you know, awareness and anxiety and stress, and it's adrenaline. So it's like, and that saves you because if a saber-toothed tiger jumps out of the bushes, you've either got to fucking climb a tree as fast as you can, run away, or fight with it. But we're not supposed to be in that state 24/7. But people who are living under stress through the news and through maybe working jobs they don't like, being programmed, growing up through their environment, to stress can become normal to people. It can become part of their personality. And then they wonder why they're getting sick. The reason why they're getting sick is 90% of sickness is caused through your thoughts. So people are the minute you start to get stressed and all that, your body basically transfers all the energy to your arms and legs to fight this saber-tooth tiger in case it jumps out and tries to eat you. But where that's taking the energy from is your gut, your immune system, and your brain. So you become less intelligent and your immune system shuts down or operates,
less capacity.
Mate, your immune system shuts down. Maybe at full capacity, at 100%. Your immune system's maybe running on 10%, 20%. And in our body, our immune system's role and job 24/7, 365 days of the year is to fight off diseases which are already in our body. So we're full of pretty much almost every disease is already in our body. They're called opportunistic parasites and germs, and they're constantly attacking our body, and our immune system, when it's functioning properly, is fighting them off. That's what it does. But all these germs and parasites and diseases live in our body, live in mine, live in all of our bodies, and your immune system is constantly fending them off. So the minute you're stressed out, your energy is going from your immune system and from your brain and into your arms, your legs, because you're in a state of survival.
Yeah, how often do you hear people go, oh, I'm run down, I'm stressed out, I've got a cold?
Yeah.
That's like the fucking saying, isn't it?
So I used to, when I was competing and fighting, because it meant so much to me, I used to worry over getting sick, and I was constantly sick.
Before the fight, like, worry about getting sick?
Yeah, I'd worry about getting sick in the camp, and I just didn't want to get sick, because I didn't want to miss one day's training. So that was my worry, and I was constantly thinking about getting sick and worrying over getting sick. I was constantly sick. I was always in the hospital with chest infections. I'd been asthmatic all my life. I'd cough once and be like, bastard, I'm getting a chest infection. Lo and behold, a week later, I'd have a chest infection. So when I started to study and learn all of this, I haven't been sick in about 7 years.
Not now.
So I've gone from being the sickest man in the world and probably the healthiest man in the world to at times eating a load of shite, but never getting sick, but being happy and you know. So it's like happiness and love and health, and I mean happiness and love and compassion and all like these things, what, like, you know, you might think, you know, it's a bit gay talking about all that, but is it gay? No, because it stops you getting sick, it boosts your immune system, it helps you live longer, it gets your immune system and your brain operating at full capacity, where the minute you're under stress in any form, your immune system is shutting down and you're less intelligent. So, because your body is pulling all the energy from where you need it most, which is obviously your immune system and your brain, and putting it into your arms and your legs. And that's why people get sick.
Mate, on that, mate, bit of a mad one, like you talk about your immune system. So I've got this thing right in me. this is one of the reasons why I always kept fit. I like keeping fit because I've always known it since I was 17, but genuinely, right, God's honest truth, one of the reasons I always maintain my fitness, whether it was the running, the world record, or the gym, whatever, is when I got blown up, the other, in the Afghan, the farmers, they use this chemical called Acinetobacter, which is like a fertilizer. So when I've been blown up, all this dust and debris and shit just went inside me, and I've now got this like infection that's in me that no one can catch it. I can't give it to anyone, nothing like that. But it's just like you were saying before, just like an added little infection that constantly tries to...
It's in your blood.
It's just in my blood.
Attacking your immune
so
system.
My white blood cells are constantly fighting it. So they say, like, I said, the doctor said, you know, you might get, you might kind of, you've got like a faster metabolism because you're burning a little bit more energy than normal. And one of the things they said to me, they was just like, just try and keep yourself, you know, fit and healthy, and, you know, it'll stop the kind of, you know, you getting sick, basically. And when I look back now, thinking back, and I knew this kind of a while back, I didn't know the science behind it until you've explained it, but any time I worried or was going through a shit time, I'd always get leg infections. I'd always get like an infection in me stump, and then I'd be off my leg, and I'd be worrying because I'm off my leg, and then it turned into a serious more infection. I'd be back in hospital. And then when I said to myself, like, I need to just start being a bit more healthier. That's like mind, body, soul, you know, getting in the gym more. And from about 2016, 2017, not had one infection in me, like, because I make sure I'm in the gym, I'm fit and healthy, I'm eating, don't get me wrong, a few beers now and again, and beers and that, but my mindset doing the speaking I've done.
You're ticking all the boxes.
My career as a speaker took me all over the world. I've got my little girl, I'm fucking walking my dog, I'm in the gym. I've not had a leg infection for 3 or 4 years.
Why do people get sick when they fly? What's everyone's reason why everyone gets sick? You see people drinking vitamin C and whatever when they're going on Aldi, and the amount of people who actually get off with a cold and whatever, the reason is not because of the bugs and all that flying around on and the germs and whatever. The reason is their perception is, when I go on this plane, I'm going to get sick, and they believe they're going to get sick every time they fly because this air conditioning is going to make me sick. Yeah. It's a load of nonsense. Yeah, don't get me wrong, yeah, they might be germs. More gyms, and might be slightly more exposed than you'd normally be. But that 4-hour flight is not the only reason why you get sick. A lot of the sickness is created in people because their perception and belief is, when I go on a plane, every time, I get sick. So when I started met Brian, this is one of the first things he told me, because I had two fights planned over 4 weeks. Now I'd always either get sick before a fight or straight after a fight. So I went to Brian, the man coach, and said, Brian, I've got a concern, I'm going to Brazil, I'm fighting twice in 4 weeks. I always get sick before or after. I've never fought twice so close together. So Brian got me to do affirmations, and the affirmations were, I had to tap here, and every morning look in the mirror and say, I am fit, I am healthy, my immune system's fucking unbelievable. And like, I had this little drill what I'd done every morning. I'd done it for the whole 5 weeks I was there. I never got sick once. I ended up fighting 3 times in 5 weeks.
Wow.
And I did feel like at times over there I was under stress and whatever, because I didn't have the understanding of what I've got now. I look back now, I was under stress and I was nervous and whatever else, but I've done these affirmations every day, and I genuinely believe, like, I won't get sick, this will work. And it worked. And then I came home, and it was as soon as I came home, it was like, mission accomplished, now I can get sick. And I was in for Zachary Ozzy for a chest infection about 5 days later. So that done me a massive favour, because it was like, that's confirmation that works.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Them affirmations work, and you can use them for your own body and your own health and whatever. You can use them for anything, in any way what they serve you. You're just telling yourself a story, affirming it to yourself, attaching emotions and feelings, and you actually create that, you know, the environment to make whatever it is what your affirmation is happening. Like I said before, like, we're speaking over like how people make themselves sick and stress, and like kind of the science behind it. But 95% of the day, this is proven, people are not aware of what they're thinking. So 5% of the day you might be in your conscious mind, it can be less, it can be 1% of the day, and 95% you're in your subconscious. Your subconscious mind is your habitual mind, your programmed mind. So when you drive a car, like, you can leave the house in the morning, drive to work, and your mind be somewhere else.
Yeah.
And you've stopped at every red light, you haven't crashed into no one, you've knocked no one off a bike, you've let a few people go to set the ripple effect up for the day. You know what I mean? And you've got to work, and you don't even know you've got there because you're operating subconsciously.
Yeah. And you can't remember the journey, can you?
You can't remember it because it's habitual. You do it without thinking. That's because you've done it for so long and it's part of your program. You can drive without actually being... Like, when you first learn to drive, You're like a bag of nerves, aren't you? And you're sweating and you're in your mirrors, and that's because you're driving consciously. Do you know what I mean? So subconsciously, people aren't aware of what their thoughts are, what they're saying to themselves, what they're affirming to themselves. And in general, most people...
Like you say, if you can fucking drive fucking half an hour and not know there, well, of course you can think all these things and not know you're thinking.
Well, you are, because 95% of the day, you've got no idea what you're thinking. So through meditation and stuff like that and studying awareness of your thoughts, what you start to do is create a larger window of where you're consciously aware of what you're thinking. And by becoming consciously aware of what you're thinking, you understand if your thoughts are negative, if you're focusing on sickness, if people are asking you how you're and you're saying it's shit, you actually realise that you're saying everything's shit because you're aware of your thoughts, because you're more in your conscious mind than you are in your subconscious. And through programming and practice and repetition, and you can literally start to change your beliefs and behaviours. Again, that's what like the likes of Bob Proctor speaks about a lot. He calls them paradigms. A paradigm is a multitude of habits. So you have a multitude of habits which you operate on from when you get up in the morning until you go to bed. So awareness of, you know, your thoughts and your behaviours is the key, because then you can start to change. That's all I do, is I'm aware of my thoughts and whether my thoughts serve me or they don't, and I change my thoughts. I'll get rid of any negative thoughts as much as I can, and obviously I'll try and be as positive as I can. And that's literally, you know, that's all it is. That's how it works one night. So if you say your average person walking down the road, he's only in his conscious mind 5% of the day, 95% he's in the subconscious, he doesn't know what he's thinking. Do you mean, you can normally tell what someone's thinking, whether, you know, you can have a positive subconscious program, and in general people are happy and grateful and nice and get everything they want without even knowing how they're doing it. And again, that can be by their environment growing up. They could have had really positive parents who instilled positivity and you know, were dead happy around them. But on the flip side, and unfortunately in a lot of you know, places around Liverpool and similar cities, people are trying to keep up with the Joneses. And being brought up in a stressful environment, stress becomes normal. Because stress becomes normal 95% of the day, subconsciously they're in a state of stress, a state of survival, creating sickness in their own body by weakening their immune systems, not getting the jobs they want, and not being creative and having self-limiting beliefs, because they're not as intelligent as they really should be if they were happy and in a state of love or happiness.
I think, mate, you're seeing that at the start of this pandemic, mate, the news, how it dumbed people down and got people stressed and I'm a bit like you, don't really watch the news, nothing. And I remember thinking to myself, like, well, God, I feel a bit, have I got this? And you know, and I was going into like stupid arguments with people, and but you know, it was just all fucking bullshit. Well, in my, that was my little opinion. You know, I was getting into invested into it so much, and I was like, this isn't. I'm normally just keeping in my own little mind, keeping fit, and I got just invested into this stupid arguments of feeling sick, and have I had it? Oh God, I don't feel great, and it did. It fucking dumbed me down, and it was only after a few weeks I was like. Because again, it was affecting me financially. I had a lot of work cancelled. I was struggling a bit. I was like, I had to just go, you know what, fucking, I want to talk about it. I'm just kind of switched off from it.
Yeah, which can be the right thing to do, because what you focus on, you're attracting, you're creating yourself. So if shifting your focus from the news and everything negative to something positive, for me, that can only benefit you. Don't get me wrong, there's bits of information and certain things going on, but you need that information. We do need it. You can't just completely shut yourself off from the world in general, but again, it's about being able to take that information without being emotionally involved in it, because as soon as you start to become emotionally involved in it, you're making yourself sick. So if you're taking that information and letting it stress you out, you know, you're basically poisoning yourself.
Yeah.
That's the only way I can.
You've got two avenues now. You've got the news, and then you've got the news on social media, and then you've got the opinion on social media.
Well, I only follow people who empower me, or if you go on my follow, like, I follow maybe 2,000 people on Instagram. I know all of them. There's not like a person on there who I don't know, who I follow, and if not someone who I know, or a class is like a friend or someone who I know, basically, it's a motivational thing. It's something which gives me information, which makes me better in some way, or I learn. Or
that's so funny you say that. Make the amount of people who go, like, you know, I can't remember it was happened years ago. This happened, and I remember calling them on it, and they said something like, "Oh, that fucking like Piers Morgan or someone does me head in." And I remember this lad, he was moaning about him all the time. Like, it was just a weird little joke. It was like, fucking hell, you've gone about Piers again. You know, it was like the Kardashians or someone like that. And in the end, I fucking was there in the pub with him, and I looked on his social, and he followed him.
Yeah.
And I went, what the fuck are you following them for then?
Yeah,
and he's like, oh, I just do it just to see.
Because he's addicted, right? So basically every emotion you have releases chemicals in your brain. And you become addicted to the chemicals. So it's the same as anything. If you eat the same thing constantly every day at the same time, or if you smoke or whatever it is, these all release different chemicals in your brain and you become addicted to them. So people become addicted to negativity. So you wonder why that person is following Piers Morgan when he hates Piers Morgan. All he does is complain about him, but he's used to his brain basically releasing these chemicals. You become addicted to these chemicals and you actually feed off negativity. And it sounds absolutely crazy, but that's how it works. You know, every emotion releases a chemical. Happy and loving and compassion and, you know, all like positive emotions, they put you in a state of growth.
And it leads back into similar minds of like-minded people. If you're surrounded by 2,000 people who you follow and they make you feel good, then obviously you're going to feel good.
I'm creating an environment which makes me grow. It's a growth environment, and that's what self-development is. It's, you know, it's learning and studying yourself so you can shed these layers, as Martin would say, which a lot of them are things what you've adopted behaviours as you've been growing up based on your environment. So we get, you know.
Mate, I remember when someone first passed me your number to try and get you onto the podcast, I think I tried to call it over a weekend, and then I think it might have been like a Friday evening, I think I might try to call you, and then you didn't get back to me until the Monday, which I'm not bothered about, but you'd left your phone, like I think you'd gone to Wales or somewhere, hadn't you?
I've got a caravan.
That was it,
like a little lodge, and we go there most weekends.
And like I think we might have touched on it last time, and you just left your phone and gone cold turkey without it, which is
fucking alien. I have anxiety thinking about that.
Yeah.
Which is so hard, especially if you've got businesses or, you know, business interests or whatever, and the family, or if you've got, you know, elderly parents, whatever it might be, which is so hard to do. And then, but like, if it is an actual emergency, like if it's, my missus, I always say this to my missus, like I turn my phone off at night for that exact reason, because I can hear, last night, like R4, you can hear, like, she's got notifications to it, which is the worst thing ever, notifications for Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, like the whole thing, you can hear it go zzz, like that, I turn my phone off. And I say, like, what if someone needs to get in contact with you? Well, like, if it's that much of an emergency, like, they'll call the police, like, or they'll call the ambulance, like, do you know what I mean? So
there's a few people who, obviously, if it was me mum, it was me closest mate, they've all got me bird number. They just ring me bird.
Yeah, I remember you saying, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And I think if you're out there and you make yourself available to people, then you're the easy option and they'll ring you. But if they know that you're not going to be on the end of the phone, then sometimes they'll use their own initiative and deal with a problem, or you know, you've got to take that time.
Yeah, if you become available too much.
If you're available, mate, they'll use you. Yeah, if you make yourself available every time they call, then you'll be there. I physically can't keep up with my phone. It's impossible. So I'll ring you back and I can ring you back in my time. It's like, well, that's not me meaning to disrespect anyone. I value my own time. You know.
There was a guy who I follow online, and he did. Basically, he ditched his smartphone completely, and he got one of these.
I've tried it.
Have you?
Driving now with a Nokia on an iPad. It didn't work.
In fact, you know Jazza doesn't even
have... Jazza's boss, yeah.
Mate, he doesn't have a phone, just a big iPad.
Jazza just rocks up with his iPad to speak to you through Instagram.
It's so funny when he turned up on an iPad. I thought he was taking the piss at first. And
I think for a fighter, that's, you know, I think it's a lot easier, I'll be honest.
You know,
if you've just got that one thing what you're involved in, and Jazz is obviously a fucking great boxer, and that's his life. So, you know, most of his stuff can be through social media, and maybe he's got a little sneaky blow somewhere that he might speak to, you know, his mum, or I don't know, maybe family members or whatever. But for me, it'd be impossible for me to get by with.
And I think, mate, what would happen with you, and this isn't me saying like it's people are wrong, but because you, mate, like again, in the impact you've had on me, mate, I've told you fucking numerous times, I think. People just want that energy, and again, if you do open yourself up too much, then they end up taking away from what's got you this life that you've got, and that's not them wanting to take away from it.
What I'm trying to work towards is to have a network of people. I've got like a friend called Claire Morton, and there's obviously Phil the Mind PT, and there's people now, obviously this is something which is growing, and people are starting to get into it. So the likes of these people, I want people to maybe come to me for helping me to be able to just direct them into the likes of them. So they're obviously earning a living out of doing something what they love doing and helping people at the same time. And I'm keeping something back for myself and my family in a weekend. Because you can't do everything.
No.
Yeah. Like, you really can't. And I think for me, anyone who carries a mobile phone around and answers every single phone call and texts someone back the minute they get a text, that's like, that phone owns you. That's how I look at it. I've been called, like, me stepbrother Stephen, he used to laugh at me and call me a phone freak and whatever, but my phone's always on silent 90% of the time. Unless I'm expecting or waiting for an important phone call, I keep my phone on silent. And if I miss a call, I miss a call, and I call them back when I'm available. Do you know what I mean? Because if I was to answer my phone and text someone back every time it rang, I wouldn't have a life.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't get to be present with my kids or present with my wife, or I wouldn't be able to train. I'd just be like on the phone.
Yeah. A lot of people will listen to that, will be aspiring to thinking, I need to fucking do that.
And I'm busy, like, I have a lot going on, but you've still got to make that time for yourself, yeah, otherwise.
Yeah. I mean, that's like a quick win that most people can do. I remember listening to the Elon Musk, did a podcast. And people say, yeah, but it won't be long until we have inbuilt computers. And he was like, we have a fucking computer that's inbuilt with us. We carry it around 24/7.
Yeah, it's glued to your hand, yeah.
Yeah, it's glued to your hand.
Mm. I've found as well, rather than, and I go through little things, and again, more and more I'm speaking to you on science, to make these more of an ongoing thing rather than just the odd day. But if you, again, you're more productive with your day, and you went, right, for an hour in the morning, I'm going to go through every social media message from the day before, do all my emails, that's the hour of the day, and then I'll do that again tomorrow.
Yeah, delegating blocks of time to deal with, rather than just doing it, trying to do everything all together. Same as what you said before, if you try and focus on five different things all at the same time, it's virtually impossible to be able to, you know, do them at your best, or, you know, to the best of your ability, or give them 100% of your time. And, you know, but yeah. I definitely think if you can delegate certain times of the day to do certain things, it's like, it does massively help. And again, that's a form of self-development, self-study, evaluating what you're doing and your behaviours. And, you know, is answering my phone every time it rings save me? Am I getting everything done? You know, well, no, what about if I just take 2 hours in the afternoon to call everyone back who's rang me that day, to speak to them, and then that frees up 2 hours after that period and 2 hours before to do this or do that. Like, if I'm working in the office, my phone will definitely be on silent, because if I'm trying to get a bit of work done,
well, yeah, and answer
every phone call, it's like,
yeah,
you know, it's impossible. I'm funny now, because I drive around, the amount of lads on building sites and the roads, and that what you see, like, I see a lad in a digger in the road, and he's meant to be working, and he's just sitting there like that. And the best thing about it is, he's in a subconscious 95% of the day, hasn't got a clue what he's thinking, has picked that up without even realising, he's on Instagram looking at his neighbours, mates, aunties, fucking, yeah. And he's meant to be in work. Do you know what I mean? In a workplace, they're probably the worst possible thing anyone can have, because it's literally, don't get me wrong, you can use them and they can serve you very well, but at the same time, they can be the biggest distraction on the planet, and for a lot of people they are. Do you know what I mean? That's what the digital detox is for, is basically, because I feel like once you take them away from parents and kids and you put them together, it's like you're just taking a massive distraction away, which means they've got to be present with whoever they were, and then brings the connectivity back, the community back.
100%. And also, like, phones are people's teddy bears. Like when they feel like uncomfortable, or like, you know, the amount of times
we leave the house and you go, fucking phone, shit.
Yeah, yeah, 100%. Like, yeah. Or you're in a bar and then you're talking to your mates, or maybe you're in a group that you don't know, and like the conversation is get down a bit, and next minute the phone's out because like it's a comfort blanket, you know.
Well, I think, mate, what it strikes me is one of the most positive things about all this is that it's not just you going, this is a good idea, this, you've seen what you're doing on the beach, you've seen with the fucking people who are asking me about a week, this is something that people have been crying out for, maybe they've not known they wanted it, or they've not known they've needed it, but there's been something in them, and they've went, fuck, like,
it's just showing someone something, that's all it is. I bang on information, I say information's one of my favourite words. Everything's information, all I'm doing is sharing information which has served and worked for me and people around me. It's like, a lot of these things, they don't just work for me, the circles I'm in, the people I'm around, we're all very similar in the sense that we're all trying to develop, we're sharing information with each other, experiences, what works for us, what doesn't. I'm aligned with a group of men every day, and these are the things what we speak about. You know, we're all giving each other advice, bouncing off each other and inspiring each other. And, you know, when you're around that kind of people, it's like I said, I mentioned Luke last time, one of the most disciplined, absolute athletes, and constantly working on himself and trying to improve. So I'm looking at people like him, like, I want to be, you know, his best attributes, that's what I'm working towards. And you're going to take someone else, you might be really disciplined with the food, like, I want to be as good as he is with his food. People who read every day and study, I'm like, I want to read as much as they do. It's like,
but not only that, don't make this a silly example, but you're giving people knowledge that maybe would never have had access to that. Because I remember when I joined the military, and after I got injured, a woman, she turned out to be a very good friend of mine, but a mentor and a great friend, and she said, do you want to go skiing? I'm fucking brutal. I've never fucking skied in my life. Didn't know you could go skiing. And I'm really good at skiing now. I've skied in fucking New Zealand, Colorado, France, Switzerland. Skied all over the world. My friends through skiing, through this knowledge that someone else gave me, because I didn't know fucking one legged lad from Brutal could go skiing. Yeah. And because of someone gave me this knowledge, she taught me, she coached me through the whole process. I've been fortunate and blessed enough now to go skiing all around the world.
And all someone's doing is giving you the gift of an experience, what they've done and they've enjoyed.
And that's what I mean. That's why you doing this with the beach and Awake, it's giving people this thing to go, just try this, come and experience
and
this.
I'm one of them. Like, I didn't know I needed to get up at 5:30 to do that circuit, to do that 10-15 minutes meditation, and to go in that cold water.
You said next week, what, you missed your sister coming and all.
I didn't know I needed it.
Yeah.
And like, when I look back at, like, again, without like beating the drum here, but when I look back at all the podcasts and things that we've done and all the stuff I've learned over my 27 years of being alive, and I look at this morning and I think, like, really, it's not that difficult. Like, I got up this morning at 5:30. So there it is. That's the first thing, is being disciplined, right? Mm. So getting up at that time.
How did that make you feel? Once you were up and you'd been on the beach and you'd done your circuit.
Oh, mate, I was fucking flying.
You've been on a high all day, haven't you?
100%, yeah. Like, literally, you should have heard the music coming out of my car. Like, do you know what I mean? So I was bouncing, yeah. So, like, first of all, discipline. Then you've got, like, that, meditation, which, to be honest, I've never really done. But I enjoyed it, really enjoyed it. Mm. Like, there was a time when it started, like, a little bit of rain, like, coming down. I could feel it. And, like, it was just, like, pure silence. I've kind of forgot about everyone, like around me. Yeah. I also forgot about, like, the...
couldn't tell there was 600 people. I didn't feel there was 600 people there.
It's like, I didn't know I needed that. So, you, like... And then look at, because obviously I knew we were having this podcast, and I remember sitting there, I said to you before, I remember after we'd done the meditation, and I think when I was looking back or whatever, once all those people had walked away, and I was thinking about yourself and questions to ask you when we came in, I was like, so what really is like, what are the key things to success, right? And I was thinking, like, first of all, it's discipline. It's getting up early, which you do all the time. The second thing is, like, giving back, which is so important, because you see billionaires doing it through philanthropy, and, like, yourself through giving up your time to do the beach thing and Awake, etc., and everything you do there. And then, like, the third thing is like, it's just, like, doing it. Do you know what I mean? It's like...
journey, isn't it?
Honestly, I came away from it thinking, like, this whole thing about success and this whole thing about getting whatever you want, and you said it afterwards, like, you can do whatever you want, like, it really isn't that hard. Like, that 5:30 was not that hard.
No.
That cold water was not that cold.
People talk themselves out of doing it. That, 100%. That's what it is, because from a negative point of view. But it really is, like... I must have said it 100 times over the last podcast and this. You've got to do the things that make you uncomfortable.
Mm.
Whether it's getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, whether it's cold water. For me, whether it's dancing with my little girl in front of a load of the scouts in the caravan park. Do you know what I mean? I used to look at them and think, I can't do that. I'd get my missile to go and dance with the baby, because I'd be too concerned over what other people around were thinking. And then... once I started to see, because the knowledge and stuff that I've studied, I started to see that having an effect on my daughter, because she started to go in with a little bit and be a bit shy and not get involved. I was like, shit, that's my fault.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? I've got to And then the next minute I'm off like it.
And you did a video, and you did a video, which I think you said you're not comfortable doing videos.
Yeah.
And you did a video.
And it's like the things one now, I'll seek discomfort, I'll seek things which I'm not comfortable with, because I know, like that feeling what you've had today, that's through seeking discomfort, that's through doing something which is out of your daily program, what you'd normally do. And it's made you feel amazing. But there's a lot of people who, again, will say, I can't get up at 4:30, I'll be knackered all day, and they'll basically just talk themselves out of it. Do you know what I mean? But it's like you got to seek these things, and the things which you wouldn't necessarily normally feel comfortable doing. That's even more, if you want to improve and be better, that's more reason to actually go and do them.
And when you seek them though as well, it propels you, I think, to the next thing, and you think you gain confidence, and you think it wasn't as bad as I thought it'd be. No. And there's, I know
it's empowering,
doing,
yeah, and, it's empowering, and it's liberating when you do things which obviously, you know, you really, really, the more uncomfortable you are overdoing them, the better you feel.
And you know, when I said it to you on the phone, but I felt like there was a little light and a little candle burning, and I feel like it's fucking turning into this forest fire in my belly. You know what I've done as well? Me and him said it for ages what I wanted to do, and it was one of those things where I was like, I know I'll do it one day, but it's actually sorted. Mate, I wanted to have a go just because I've had loads of crazy things happen to me in my life, loads of mad stories, funny stories. I wanted to get up on stage and do comedy, you know, just get,
yeah.
Man, it's boxed, it's boxed. I'm not telling anyone when and where or nothing, but it's boxed, and it's something I spoke about for ages. And I went for a coffee with my mate today, Chris Cairns. Shout out to Chris.
I thought you were gonna say like fucking jump out of a plane or something like that.
I've done all that, man. I've done this for me. I've just always wanted that feeling. Because again, I'm like you. I've had like a crazy life through the Marines and through injury and through. I've done bungee jumps. I've done all that stuff. But I love that feeling of like, fuck,
butterflies.
This
yeah.
could go fucking wrong here, or this could be great. And I think standing on stage in front of 100 people and trying to make them laugh for 5 minutes is pretty...
5 weeks ago, the first... So Martin's got a pretty big WhatsApp group. A lot of the people, they've all done like his meditation courses and all that. So I'm quite new to the group, and I don't know a lot of people in the group because it's just a little name comes up on the WhatsApp thing, but I've got a few good mates in there. So I put in the WhatsApp group literally 5 weeks ago, because we've been going a couple of weeks and but they've been doing it for a little while, going and just doing a meditation and doing a dip in the sea. So I put on the group, anyone fancy getting there at 5:30, half an hour before, and we'll do a circuit before we go on the beach. Mark, put a post next minute, I'm just driving down, get tagged on some thing on Instagram. It's saying 5:30 circuit with Mark Scano, 6 o'clock meditation with Martin Bone. And then obviously cold water swim, and honest to God, my heart just went bang.
Yeah.
Just like, literally shit myself. But then obviously because the way, you know, everyone was speaking about now, it's like they're the uncomfortable things. What?
Totally, man.
So every excuse was coming into my mind, but at the same time, I'm like, I wouldn't allow myself to, it all them excuses are coming in, them reasons not to do it, but that gives me more reason to do it.
Yeah.
So I didn't have a clue what to expect. So anyway, the Thursday morning pulls up at like 5:30, and there's about 50 people on the beach waiting for me, all like jumping up and down, like loosening off. And honest to God, I sat there and thought, what excuse can I give to turn around and drive away? And that's obviously like the devil on that shoulder, and then the angel on that shoulder just goes, what the fuck are you talking about? Get on that beach and practice what you preach. So the next thing, I'm on the beach, you know what I mean? And then 5 weeks later, there's fucking 600 people on there, and we've designed the ultimate morning.
Boston,
you know, and that's a perfect example of, you know, I could have said,
imagine if you'd said, oh lad,
I can't do that. That's you know.
So have you read that book? Is it called The Monkey Paradox?
The Chimp Paradox.
Chimp Paradox.
Yeah, it is.
Cracking book, that, isn't it? That's like that, like where the monkey's in the mind telling you, like, but it hasn't got the facts. And
I think I don't know if I told you, but one of the hardest things I'd done was the Liverpool Marathon. And I broke the 10k record. I got a pretty good 5k time, half marathon time, and I tried to take on the marathon, but I couldn't run longer distances. My stump was getting really battered and bruised, so I'd only ran 17 miles, and I come to race day and I got to like 18 miles. I was fucking dying. I was on for like a 3.5 hour marathon. I ended up doing it in 4:20, but I was on for a really good time. And just how your mind works, it was, mate, my mind was going, you know, just if your leg breaks now, just whack your leg against that. And if it breaks, you've got an excuse now. The prosthetic leg's broken. You know, all these mad things are coming to my head. It's giving me reasons to quit and reasons to stop and excuses. And I had my little girl at the finish line. And I was like, no, there's fucking no way. But it was those two little things, devil and angel. And yeah. The amount of shit your brain says for excuses and just do
most
that.
Most mental excuses.
Yeah, just do that and that's your reason.
Yeah, just like the most creative excuses you've ever heard in your life.
No one can say, and if you say that, you know, your leg fell off, you know, what can you say? No one can say, it's like, it's a fucking prosthetic leg. And I'm like, no, come on, keep going. And it's just mad how you've got to control those thoughts.
Yeah, but once you commit to basically say to yourself, doesn't matter how uncomfortable I feel, them things what make me feel uncomfortable, I'm going to attack them.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? Aggressively, I'm going to fucking run at whatever makes me feel like awkward or embarrassing or, you know, they're the things you've got to, because a lot of them, they are literally just self-limiting beliefs and stuff, what you've adopted through your environment growing up. And they're the things that hold you back from becoming your true self and doing what you're supposed to be doing, what you basically, you know, I don't believe you've got one purpose, but I believe everyone has got a purpose. And the only thing what stops them from achieving it is themselves. Do you know what I mean? And these limiting beliefs and stuff, what, you know, someone else, basically absorbing someone else's limiting beliefs and that becoming part of your personality. And the beauty about, again, the stuff what Martin teaches, it's like he calls it shedding layers, and it's literally, you know, you imagine that you're just shedding these layers, and all it's doing is to discover who you are, to discover yourself. You know, once you discover yourself, you become to doing what it is you're supposed to be doing, and that's how I feel at like right now. Like I'm in the most,
you're in that moment where you,
my life's absolutely perfect in every way, and I feel that's because I'm in a position where, you know, maybe I wouldn't have been in that position 3-4 years ago because of work and whatever, but I've created circumstances which have put me in that position to be able to live how I want to live. And what I love doing is using knowledge in my own experience. It actually motivates me to learn more and become better myself, to be able to share that then with other people. Do you know what I mean?
It comes from like this self-fulfilling prophecy then, because the more you're learning about yourself, people are then attracted to you because it's making them feel good. Yeah. And you're buzzing off them feeling good.
I always say, if you're a generous person, you know, then, and you love giving, which deep down I believe everyone loves giving. I don't believe anyone should be self, like deep down I don't believe anyone is selfish. We're all born and put on this planet to give and serve each other. We're all one. Everyone's connected, from us to trees to the whole world connected. So for me, it makes perfect sense for your deepest purpose to be to provide a service for other people. Do you know what I mean?
Maybe what you being in that state there, you just said, just made me think of this question that we got asked before. One of that guys, Greg, who's signed up on the Patreon as well. It's a nice one, Greg. His question is for Scano. He said he loved the last one. He said, this is like, it's like the first question I'm asking, you know. But it's... he said, if you were only to give 3 golden rules to better your life, what would they be? Only 3.
Wake up early's got to be number one, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
you wouldn't have your win your mornings, win your day if you didn't get up early.
Give more than what you paid for. It's definitely number 2. It doesn't matter what, if you provide a genuine fucking service for someone, then it will come back to you. That's 1,000,000%. And mate, I just say fucking be, you know, in fact the number 3's got to be, do not give a shit what anyone thinks about you. Because like, going back to my mum, you were speaking about my mum before, like, without there's definitely no violin involved, because I'm grateful for every single thing whatever happened to me in my life. But my dad went on errand when I was 2, and my mum was pregnant with my little brother. So if there's one saying or quote or anything more I can remember my mum saying, it was, do not copy anyone else and don't do what everyone else does around you to fit in. Because that's basically what my dad done, and he's still on heroin now. Do you know what I mean? So, like, obviously, like I give a lot of praise and whatever to my mum, but that was the one thing what stuck with me, and that's one thing that I really try and push into the kids in the schools, into my own kids. It's like the importance of not giving a shit what anyone thinks about you is absolutely massive, because then if you do give a shit what everyone thinks about you, you're living your life for everyone else.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's like, how can you be happy if you're living your life for other people? You live your life for yourself to benefit your loved ones and the people around you. So it's like, that's got to be, you know, out of the 3 of them, I say, yeah, get up early, you know, work hard. I can give you 10, but I'd definitely say a massive one.
Don't
you know, especially for any youngsters who are listening, or people who do know that they live in the fear of being judged by other people. You know, just don't give a shit. Mm. You know, I know who I am, uncomfortable in who I am. I'll be driving down the road. It's like true story. This, I'll be driving down the road and whatever. I've had people pull up next to me, shouting at me, and different things. And I don't think, well, I better get out and have an argument with him, or confront him, or beat him up. Because if I don't, he's going to think I'm a dickhead. I'm not asked. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So I've had people roaring at me and cars up the arse of my car and shouting at me, and like, I'm pretty confident. I've said it before. Put me on a field with anyone, and I'm confident. You know what I mean? And I know, without saying like a dickhead, I know I'm an hard case. That's fact. Everyone, I'm fucking trained for most of my life and fought at a high level. So yeah. If you're an average man on the street, I can have a fight, but if someone pulls up next to me and's giving me abuse or whatever, like, I can honestly say I'm not comfortable in myself. I can't even be asked. I'll apologise even if I haven't done nothing wrong most of the time. Just because I'm, you know, I just can't be bothered.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, again, that's like these, like, I have these conversations with the kids in the schools because they think, like, you know, you've road rage and someone confronts you and you've got to do this and got to do that. But really, again, that's just your ego. I'm a big believer in a lot of the stabbings and stuff, what's going on in town now. That's kids who are insecure, scared. Obviously, nobody can fight to save their life. Going out, taking a knife with them, fucking getting drunk, taking all kinds of drugs, and just making the biggest mistake of their life, unintentionally. Do you know what I mean? And they're doing that because of an insecurity, because they can't fight. Do you know what I mean? They may have never had a fight, or they just physically, they don't train, they don't exercise. And deep down, they might stick their chest out and think they're the big hard cases and gangbangers and whatever, but they can't fight to save their life. And if you got older, one of them, they didn't have a knife or anything, they cried their eyes out. Do you know what I mean? Then you put a knife in their hand and a bevy and a bag of Charlie and time the next minute someone's dead.
Yeah. So mate, it's with fighters as well, it's like, obviously we've had Jazzy, yourself, and Tony on, but like, if anyone you'd expect to fight, you'd expect fighters to fight, like, you know, on the street, and yet not, like, none of them are like anywhat interested in street fights.
And Jordan Peterson, there's a video, I think I might have sent it to you actually, and I'm like, it really, really resonated with me. It's like, train to be the most dangerous man on the planet, the most violent and dangerous man on the planet, and then spread and teach love. Do you know what I mean? So like, make yourself as hard as you can, and then preach love and teach love, and, you know, really, that's what I'm about. Yeah. I can look after myself if I ever needed to, or I got put in a situation where I had to have a fight. Like I said, I'm not scared of no one. But I don't want to, unless I've really got to, unless someone harms someone in my family or someone really close to me, then, you know, if I'm not put in a situation where I've got to defend myself, I fucking train twice a day, Monday to Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I can't be arse rolling around on a centre reservation with some fella on Queen's Drive because I've cut him up, or he's cut me up, and we've got into an argument. I'd rather just apologise and get on with me day.
It's such nonsense, isn't it? Mate, and that trying to prove, like, that trying to prove yourself, I think, covers not only fighting but anything, like, in money. Like, we've all seen the people who are trying to be something they're not. Like that phrase, you know, when you buy material things, who are you actually trying to impress? Are you trying to impress yourself, or are you trying to impress someone else?
You spend
else,
the money,
you know,
which you haven't got, on things, what, you know, just to impress someone else.
Yeah, and like, yeah.
You know, what for?
Yeah.
I always remember, I think I told it a million times, I always remember this lad fucking buying, he bought a £700 pair of webs. His rent in his house was £600 a month. And I thought, you can fucking live in your house for a month for £100 less than what you pay for your shoes. Yeah. And it was just so he got fucking latest pair of webs on. You're like...
But that unfortunately, that is the world we live in. And like I said, over Liverpool is a special. I'm so proud to be from Liverpool. But at the same time, that competitiveness can send you one way and create amazing people. But in the other sense, it can put a lot of people into struggle and stress, and that's what it does. So, like, again, another mission with the stuff what we're doing with Awaken Things is to teach people to you can feel whole without keeping up with the Joneses. If you like a pair of shoes or a certain top or whatever, go and buy it. Don't be scared to be different. You know, if you see something you like, don't think you'll be judged on it. Or, you know, at the end of the day, the people who are judging you, you really give a shit what they think anyway. Did they matter?
Yeah.
But we're just bred into that thing where, like, you care too much about what people think, and, you know,
keeping up with the Joneses.
Yeah, and you're not living your life for yourself. You're living your life for other people by giving too much concern to what other people's opinions are.
Mm.
And really speaking, they do not matter. Mm. They don't at all. Do you know what I mean?
Mate, I had a question just before.
Can you say as well, mate? What's the kind of vision then for a week? So obviously it's opening. It'll be today when this pod's out. You've got the four classes a day for adults and the one every day for the kids. Where can you kind of see this, like you say, by the beach? You didn't know that.
Yeah, fucking 600 there'll be, people. By this time next year, there'll be three centres getting 600 kids a week through the doors, giving them free classes on meditation, mindfulness, yoga, fitness. We'll be running all the workshops on business, on nutrition, on psychology, just information for the parents then to obviously support the kids and support themselves. You know, it'll be a great business. You know, like I said, it'll make money, but we'll give a hell of a lot back.
Mm.
At the same time, that's a business for me where if it didn't make any money, I wouldn't be bothered. If what we made profit just paid for the kids' sessions and whatever else, I'd be more than satisfied and happy. I don't want no government funding. I don't want a pound off no one. I just want to create a system. You know, we've created, me and people who are around, I've created businesses to earn money for ourselves and you know, achieved and got whatever I feel I've got, whatever I need. I'm pretty much in a position now where I'm absolutely fine, I don't need nothing. But if I can do it for myself, then why not go and do it for other people and manifest and create these businesses which are sustainable, which give a service back and add value and health and happiness to other people's lives. And that's like that for me, that right now feels like my true purpose. Do you know what I mean? And I absolutely love it. Like I'm springing out of bed before my alarm's going off in the morning.
You must be buzzing for this a week to open now.
Yeah, so we'll have three centres by this time next year. We've got one up by Garston that's going to be done in the next 3-4 months. And again, I just want to say a massive thank you to my partners on that, because I told them what we were doing and what the vision was, and they're right behind it and want to fund and sponsor and you know, they don't have to do that. You know, that's just money what's basically coming out of their own pocket and out of the business to help build Awaken. You know, I'll have three centres anyway by this time next year. Six classes a week, free for kids and everyone. I'll have schools coming to visit them. I'll have boxing clubs bringing the kids in, football clubs bringing the kids in. I'll have all the classes for the adults. And out of each one, I'll be sending maybe 150, 180 people out every morning, mate, just letting the ripple effect, you know, raising the vibration of Liverpool, so to say. So that's the plan and that's what's happening. Like that will...
It's on the record.
Yeah.
So I think his name's Jack Dempsey. He's put, how long did it take to build how long did it take you to build your first business? And advice for young people starting a business?
The best advice I give is don't be scared to fail. You know, I'm not scared of trying. I've tried loads of things and they failed. Like me and my partner Dave, a couple of years ago, spent a lot of time and money. When I say a couple of years ago, maybe about 5-6 years ago now, but we spent time and money, which didn't even belong to us, trying to create this inflatable cinemas on the Albert Dock.
Did you?
Yeah. And, we spent months and months, borrowed money, got other people's money to invest into it, and end up having to pay them back out of the next bit of money or whatever what we made. And, you know, I've tried different like food businesses and stuff like that, and a lot of them haven't worked, but... You know, fortunately, you know, the ones that I've worked have put me in a good position and
just keep trying.
Right, but just mate, if you have, go with your gut. If you get a feeling, like I always believe that reoccurring ideas are there for a reason, and it got explained to me once that you have reoccurring ideas. He said every idea is basically, imagine it's a balloon in the sky with a piece of string, and when you have these ideas, you're pulling the balloon down and you're holding onto it, and if you don't act on it, you're letting the balloon go. And someone else might get the balloon in 6 months, pull that balloon down, act on it, and create a successful business. And the reason why you haven't is because you've let that balloon go. So I believe if there's a couple of balloons and they come down, it's the same, you keep getting the same balloon, then you've got to do something about it, because I think the worst thing you can do is live with the regret of not trying and then see someone else.
Mm. I forget his name. And he talks about the graveyard being the biggest thing of ideas.
Yeah.
Because people have these ideas, and like you say, they're trying to be sheep. They're too scared of what people think. They're too scared to act on them. And the graveyard, the cemetery, has got the most ideas in it, because no one.
A lot of people, look at there's people who've earned, created multi-million pound businesses out of cleaning windows, and they only started on, say, Prescott Road cleaning windows, but they love cleaning windows. And the next thing you know, they're getting contracts in town, and it goes from town, they might touch for a contract in Manchester. That's genuine, because they found something what they love doing, and they're giving 110% to it because they love it. All the greatest footballers, the greatest fighters, you know, I mean, like the elite of the elite, they wouldn't be where they are unless they actually loved what they're doing. So again, that's important to whatever you're doing. Don't do something just for the money.
Yeah. And mate, there's businesses, you know what I mean? For literally, you only have to drive down the street and there's a business for anything. Like on this table, that bottle water, like that bottle manufacturer, do you know what I mean? Or these cable manufacturers. Or
I always say that story with the speaking. For me, I got asked to do this. I never got into it. Someone said, can you come and speak in the school? Just talk to the kids about what the Marines were like, done that. What was Iraq like, done that. What Afghanistan was like, done that. Next minute I got asked to speak in Bootle Town Hall. Again, all just, Andy, will you do this for a favour? 7 years later, Nike, who I've been wearing my whole life, put me on a plane business class to Shanghai to speak to 20 of their...
Delta.
And I'm like, I'm getting paid. Mate, I was there for 3 days. I was treated like a fucking celebrity. They put me on a fucking... gave me my own tour guide. It was just my beck and call.
Yeah.
I felt like a rock star. Got paid a fucking good amount of money from it. Got paid a good amount of money, and I was thinking, I've got to here now because I just love doing this, sharing my story. Yeah. And I never ever thought, God, I can earn a couple of quid out of this. It come from that passion. It's mad, isn't it, where, like you say, I've thought of ideas and think this. Like,
it doesn't matter what it is. It can be literally anything. You know, the things you'd least expect it.
Yeah.
Like the other thing with science, it's just that a lot of people who don't know where they're going or what they're doing, and they get in this sort of lost, frustrated. You know, the only way is down if you end up in that state, because what you're looking for is not just going to appear from nowhere if you're not in the right frame of mind. The best thing you can do is set yourself a period of time, so to say, or just set out every day to constantly learn and develop. So make your primary goal just improving yourself. Now, if that means you've got a 9-to-5 job, which you don't enjoy doing, and you're earning a certain amount of money, which, you know, maybe you're on minimum wage or whatever, that job is just a base. Basically what that job's just going to do is fund the extra time that you've got to work on yourself and improve yourself. So if you do a 9-to-5, but you can get up in the morning at 5 o'clock, and you can spend 2 hours studying, exercising, putting yourself in a happy, like, I can't stress how important it is to leave that house in the morning and go into work environment or wherever you're going in a great state, because no one wants to work with anyone in a negative state. Do you know what I mean? If you're in a boss place and you're happy and you help people and you've got a smile on your face and you're nice to be around, opportunities come.
Yeah. And even if it's a job, like you say, that's serving its purpose, it's perspective. And if you're just getting up thinking, I'm in this dead end job because I need the job because this and that, whereas if you're getting up 2 hours early and you're working on yourself for 2 hours, you're turning up for work and you might hate that job, but you're smiling going, you know what, I'm working on myself.
It's changing your perspective, so that job is enabling you to work on yourself. So you might look at that job and your perspective be, this job's absolutely shit, I hate it, I've got to do it 9-to-5. But if you know at the end of the day, if you're working on yourself for 12 months and you get to the point where you're attracting better people and, you know,
you end up getting a promotion in the job and you end up fucking loving it.
The opportunities come from the places when you least expect them, but they only come when you put, when you're basically putting yourself in a position to deserve them and you attract them. It's like, you know, that's how it works. You've got to better yourself and become a better person if you want better opportunities. The more you increase your value to fucking the world, the more valuable you become, the more people will pay you for whatever service it is what you're doing.
Yeah. It's that bond that is now. I always remember as a kid, a speaker came in our school and he went, right, he wants this fiver. I just went, yeah, you know, I will. He went, who wants this fiver? And he'd just done it a few times. He went, who wants this fiver? And then someone just got out of the class and walked up and took it off him. And he's like, if you want something, you got to go and get it. And he fucking gave the kid the fiver. This when we were all kids, and we were all like, fucking hell,
why did we get it?
Missed out there, haven't I?
None of us wanted it.
My dad had been rare up there. I'd have been like that with people, you know, when I was in school.
But the greatest bit about it was, I thought, you know what, you've got to, if you want to better yourself, you've got to get up at 5 in the morning, do 2 hours before the job that you don't like or whatever.
But a lot of people look at things and think that's too easy or too good to be
true.
And again, like, the advice I give on that is you've got to explore everything, because you just don't know where opportunities and things go. Most of the stuff I'm involved in, I didn't wake up in the morning and plan it or like I said, I've just been constantly working on myself, trying to become a better person, helping people where I can. And they just come from nowhere, because in general, if you're a nice person and people know deep down your intentions are pure and you want to help people, you know, then people do want to give you something back. And if there's an opportunity, they will come to you. If you've got, you know, you've got two different people, A and B. A is positive, goes out, helps people every day, and a nice person. You've got B is miserable, watches the news all day, you know, and is not very nice to be around. It's common sense. Yeah. It's that simple. Who's going to get the opportunities, A or B? Do you know what I mean?
So, we've seen it with the podcast, haven't we? We started it off with the right intentions, and 18 months later now, people, you know, we're speaking to yourself, we've got Martin, tons of guests who just want to come on and share the story, and then, you know, we end up getting this office space from Rob, other offices, spaces are getting offered to us, and like, people are, and it's just like, it's mad how things, just opportunities just come your way from just doing things for the right reasons, yeah, and trying to kind trying, of, you know.
Yeah, in a sense, shedding all these layers is what Martin spoke about this morning. It's getting out of your own way. Because all these layers and all these self-limiting beliefs, never, they all get in your way. They stop you from becoming the person who you're supposed to be. So when you start to work on self-mastery and learning about yourself and constantly developing yourself, you're shedding these layers. And by shedding the layers, you're basically, you know, getting rid of the things that don't serve you, which opens doors for, you know, basically becoming your true self, being who you're supposed to be, doing what you're supposed to be doing, because that's all it's for. All the self-mastery and the meditation and the awareness is literally to try and figure out who you are, and in turn, what, you know, what should you be doing, what you want to be doing.
How can you give back to the world? Yeah.
I just wanted to say as well, like, you just raised a good point before. It's like, when you say about being successful and whatever that might be, and being kind and giving back, it's so funny because, like, certainly when I was growing up, we are somewhat taught that successful people are, and the words that's thrown around a lot with successful people, specifically with money, is they're ruthless. Oh yeah, Steve was really ruthless when he was, you know what I mean? He didn't care about anything. But like, you know, it's completely different. Like, that giving back and being kind. Well, do you know what I mean? It's like, it's such a weird, like,
people who are ruthless in terms of earning money and stuff like that are slave to money.
Yeah.
And I guarantee they'll never be happy. They might be happy when they touch with some money, but they constantly want more. And I think I'd said it on the last podcast, there's nothing wrong with being dissatisfied. Dissatisfied is a growth state. Because if you were satisfied, you'd stop growing.
Yeah.
We should never stop growing. We should grow until the day we die in some form, in one way or another. If you're not growing, you're dying. And that's true. But dissatisfaction is a growth state. But you've got to be grateful and feel blessed and happy at the same time. And when you combine the two, the satisfaction with being, you know, grateful, it's like it's the purest fucking the best way to achieve. And then, because what you're saying is, I'm not happy, I'm dissatisfied, and I want to grow and I want to become more, but I'm grateful for where I am now.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it's like, people, there's a misconception where people think by saying you're dissatisfied, you're being unappreciative. I'm the most grateful man on the planet, but I'll always grow in some form or another. I'll always be dissatisfied in some way, where I know there's always some way I can be better, whether it's a better husband, a better dad, you know, better in business, better in giving, better in my physical self. It's like, there's always a way you can be growing. It doesn't have to be financially. Do you know what I mean? And that's why I stressed before over people who are lost and don't know where they're going, maybe with a business or whatever, they get frustrated and they start to get like a little bit lost, and it can be a downward spiral and they can't get out of it. Just commit 100% to working on yourself and bettering yourself, and when the opportunities come, the opportunities will be better. Do you know what I mean? The better you become, the better the opportunities, the more value you've got to offer people.
Like, one quote I love, mate, and I think you've summed it up perfectly by saying that, by, you know, working on yourself and opportunities will, you know, open up, is when people have said to me in the past, and like, maybe they're not happy with themselves or something like that, and they go, oh, you're lucky to be doing that, lucky this, lucky that. Say, luck is when opportunity meets when preparation meets opportunity.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, you've prepared and put yourself in that best possible situation by, you know, working on this or yourself or this and that, and then an opportunity comes up. You know, it's not just like luck just didn't land on you.
There's no such thing as luck.
No,
there's no such thing as luck. There's no such thing as coincidence. Everything just happens how it's supposed to happen. You know, you can speak about karma and stuff like that. Karma is a real thing for me. You know, and so is, like I said before, the law of compensation. So, you know, what you give out, you get back. Like we said last time, necessarily doesn't mean what I do for you, I expect back from you. Everything to do with it, no expectation from anyone. I just do it because I want to do it, because it feels right to give, feels right. But the law of compensation, it does come back in some form. It can be money, it can be happiness. If like, you know, they say that one of the most selfish things you can do is give, because the feeling what you get back get what you receive back, do you know what I mean?
I've done gigs, mate, right, where I've done this gig and I've thought, oh, I'm going to get X amount of money for this. It's a big corporate gig, fucking buzzing. And I've went and done it and I've met someone and I've had a connection with them. And then I've been on the train back from London and I've had this message of someone and my head's completely fell off. It's been so, like, you know, I spoke to them the night before, maybe for like half an hour or something, and then they followed it up the next day where I just want to thank you again, Andy, for your time. I really appreciate your talk, and then for spending some time after me, and, you know, thanks for it all. And I've been like maybe thinking, oh, this is going to be a good little payday or something, and I've come away from it. The fucking money was the last thing on my mind, you know, that feeling of just like, wow, I've kind of turned up thinking this will be successful financially, and the feeling I've got to make it a success was the feeling of gratitude and just like, wow.
But again, there's a misconception where people think you need to be happy or you can earn money.
It can be both.
People can feel guilt over earning money, but like I said, if you're adding value to the lives of people, enough money's earned off making people sick and killing people. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think that the worst thing you can do is feel negative toward, like, if I'm not a big fan of the new notes. So the new notes are plastic, aren't they?
Oh, yeah.
And you'll be in a shop and you'll go to pull a tenner out of your pocket and your money's on the floor, or you're trying to count like 20 quid or something, and it's, you know, I love money, you know, you've got to say you love money to attract money, but like I'm very careful over, like I've been in a shop and I've gone to like count money to pay for shopping, or do you know what I mean, I've gone, I hate these new notes, and I'm like, should I say that?
Yeah.
And then I've gone, nah, I'm only messing, I love these new notes. They're all right, they're just a bit annoying, aren't they, the way, like, but no, they're sad, you know what I mean? So, you know, yeah, definitely where money's concerned, you know, money's great if you've got good intentions. I said last time, my motivation for earning money has always been for what I can do.
Gives you the platform, doesn't it?
For other people, yeah. And like, we live in a world where you do need money, you know, if you want to go on Aldi. Like, I believe that we should all live in total abundance. Doesn't mean we all will, but I believe we should be able to go where we want to go and do what we want to do. You know, so the ultimate goal for me has always been to put myself in a position where I can travel anywhere I want to travel. I can have what I want to have, and I don't have to, like, basically, you know, look at a price or something and say, do I deserve it or don't I deserve it? Because I believe that, you know, you should be able to have and what you want. I know some people might hear that and think that's unrealistic, but their paradigm's obviously different to mine, you know what I mean? I believe you should be able to have anything what you want and what you need. It doesn't mean you've got to have a certain amount of money, but if you want to live a certain way, then obviously that costs a certain amount of money, and you've got to be able to earn that amount of money to be able to do the things what you want to do. That's ultimately, that's freedom, do you know what I mean, where money's concerned.
It definitely brings freedom.
Mate, I want to just not only thank you again, mate, and tell everyone to go down to Awake. So it's Instagram is the best, isn't it? And the website as well.
Instagram, yeah.
Instagram.
And it's just Awake Liverpool on Instagram.
Awake Liverpool. So get down there today and, you know, find out of it on Instagram. This is Monday the 10th.
Yeah, Monday the 10th, yeah.
Make sure you're down on Thursday. And, mate, to finish off, because I thought that was the best bit of the pod, that, mate, the three golden rules. Get up early.
Get up early, mate, yeah.
Number two.
I can't even remember what was number two.
Number two was always...
Number three distracted me.
Yeah. No, number one was get up early. Two was always give more than what you pay.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Don't be scared to give it away, because, you know, the Jim Rohn, one of my favourite quotes, and again, Jim Rohn, YouTube Jim Rohn, self-development master, unbelievable. Bob Proctor, you know, all these people message me on Instagram and I send them all these little videos, just the same as
sometimes
random people, but there's Jim Rohn, there's Bob Proctor, there's Les Brown, the great motivation.
Les Brown was the one who said about the graveyard.
Les Brown's boss, yeah. Then you've got like a Greg Braden, you've got Joe Dispenza, there's a guy called Alan Watts, he's like a little bit
Alan Watts,
spiritual.
Yeah.
Alan Watts is my favourite
ever.
Yeah,
motivation and what if money was no object.
Yeah, so it's like these are the people I watch these videos every single morning. These are, again,
I'll send a couple to you and you're like, lads, seeing it.
I've watched thousands of hours of videos. The material, what's on YouTube, is like...
Yeah. And it's free.
It's free, mate, yeah.
Yeah.
And you can if you subscribe, you can... Like, I've subscribed, so I download videos, so it doesn't matter where I am. I've got a playlist of videos. I've created videos that put me in a space where... I feel like I need to be to give my best to everyone else, and that's what I do. Mm. You know, we go back to win your mornings, win your days. Design a program which basically suits your life, the lifestyle what you want. You know, and you've got to tweak it and change it to work for you. It's not what works for me might work for everyone, but I can definitely say, get up at 5, meditation in the morning, cold showers, gratitude. I'm massive on gratitude. Like I say, thank you fucking 100 times a day. I've got my own little rituals and things like that where, like, you know, to make sure I'm constantly being grateful. So your cold showers.
Can I just ask, just on that cold shower, yeah. I see on your Instagram, have you got like a hose set up outside or something?
So go on Amazon, the best £25 you'll ever spend in your life. It just connects to your hose pipe and runs straight out, freezing cold water.
I've
like in my back garden, I've got trees at the back, so like I finish training in the morning, literally strip off in my garden. I've got no one backing out to me, so I'm all right. And just walk over, turn this cold shower on after training for an hour, and it's like, mate, I just literally stand there, just fucking under the trees with this freezing cold water running all over me. And like, it's amazing. Like, it's a little 5 minute, it is like a form of meditation where when I first started getting in, I might have been a little bit like, but now it's one of the highlights of my day. Yeah, I come out feeling dead clean and fresh. And you know, it was £25 next day delivery on Amazon, so...
Yeah, that cold shower, mate, even... That's one of the first things I've done after we spoke last time, and... Mate, it's already got easier, and you don't realise how much it's in your mind, and you control it with your breathing.
Yeah.
You know, it's cold, but you're like...
Wim Hof's another one, so for people, definitely, you know, Google, YouTube Wim Hof. He's got an amazing story. And yeah...
And the last one was don't give a fuck or anything.
Mate, just everyone, please just stop caring what people think about you, because it's holding you back. It's the main thing, especially in Liverpool, because we're all so competitive, and it's the main thing holding you back. You know, you're like a man. I got upset this morning. I'm not really, like, I don't cry very often, do you know what I mean? I get upset, but I'm at a point where, you know, people know it, because I really don't care what anyone thinks. I wouldn't be doing these things on the beach and, you know, singing to me bird this morning on me live thing on the way to the beach, and I'm really not asked, and there's no better feeling than just being yourself, doing what you want to do, and not letting all, you know, the opinions of other people hold you back or make you basically be the person who you're not. Do you know what I mean? That's like, you know, if I can come away from you and give anyone any advice, especially in this city, stop giving a shit what people think. It doesn't fucking matter.
What a way to end.
Yeah.
Mate, that was 2.5 hours.
Was it?
Was it?
Yeah. That's gone pretty quick, isn't it?
Fucking hell, mate.
Your phone will definitely really have messages to
it. I will.
Is there anything else you want to say before anything else about Awake or anything else you want to plug or...
Do you know what, mate? I'd just like to give a little shout out to Martin and Mark, my mate, who's doing the litter pick. What Mark's doing is amazing. 40 days, mate.
We've got him coming on. He's got six
kids, and he's out every day picking up litter and just trying to help people. He hasn't got much money. You know, he's struggling at the minute, but he's still out there every day.
Amazing. You know, he's coming on to share the story, mate. I can't wait to hear about it.
Mm.
Can't wait. On a Mission MC.
Mate, thank you so much for your time, everyone. Thanks so much for this morning, honestly. Yeah.
Cool, mate.
It's fucking just legend.
We're winning, aren't we, Tom?
Mate, we're flying. I'm fucking flying. Listen, I'm going Crosby Beach.
I can feel it. You know what's boss? Because, like, I'm a big, like I said, over energy transfers, and I am very, like, receptive to other people's energy. If I'm around someone in the negative, before I've even walked in the room, I'm like, there's someone negative in there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But you can, it, for me, like, it really is nice when you meet people and you speak to them, and, you know, and you feel the energy is different, and you can see it even now, mate. You're beaming, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, fucking, mate. Honestly, I can't thank you enough.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for obviously having me on, and we're definitely reaching a lot of people.
Mate, you're welcome back anytime, you really are. Thank you so much, mate.
Yeah, thank you.